Hello, this is the GRKade Twitchcast. It's the sixth episode, I believe. Yes. Going to say it's the sixth episode, even if it's the 12th, it's the sixth now. And today we're going to be discussing several things. To be honest, Doom have done most of the looking into what to talk about this week. Apart from the SNES data mining on the Switch, I actually am not quite sure what I'm going to be told about. So realistically, today it's all on Doom. So Doom, take it away.
Hello. Yes. Kind of. It's almost like a lead on from last week. It was very Doom centric last week, and today it kind of carries on almost. So
yeah.
Works in my favor. Anyway, yes, thank you for tuning in. Thought we would, it's something that I think we'll do a little more often, and that's actually have a look at any new interesting kind of new stories that have come out in the gaming kind of industry in the last week or so. So I think this, you know, even if it just covers a 10-minute segment of the Twitch cast, it's worth doing, I think.
Definitely.
Just to keep people up to date. So, you know, I think this is the first time we're doing it. So, giving it a go. Peds doesn't know what I've got lined up. So, any reactions and from him will be as genuine as they can be. Not that there are any major breaking news stories, but I always find it interesting when these things are... when you don't know what's coming, because you get an instant reaction, which sometimes is nice to hear rather than something thought out and not scripted, but you see what I mean. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so we'll get the little bits out the way first, and then we'll work on the main story. So the first one I found is that Call of Duty, the Battle Royale mode for Call of Duty called, I think it's called Blackout, is now open on a free to try basis. I think this is access on Xbox, PS4 and PC, so on all systems. Do you have any interest in A, Call of Duty, B, Battle Royales, and can you see yourself trying this at all?
Me personally, I haven't played a Call of Duty game probably since Modern Warfare 2.
Wow. That was a while ago.
So it has been a long time since I've properly played one.
Mm.
Battle Royale games, I did play PUBG a bit with a couple of friends. Jasm, who has been on the Twitch cast with us. Xanthem, who... he has signed up to GRKade, but I think he doesn't really use forums much because, you know, he's strange. But yeah, I played some PUBG and some Fortnite. And while they're quite fun with a couple of people, unless there's going to be a group of us trialing this mode, I will not bother because I don't see the point in playing him. It's like solo, it's crap. What about yourself?
I haven't really got a lot of experience with the Battle Royale mode. I've played a little bit of Fortnite because obviously it was when it was free for the Xbox, download it and try. And I wasn't enamored with it at all. I see why people like it, you know, I do see it.
Yeah.
But for me, it's a game of hiding who can hide the best and then who can get the first shot off at the end. That's kind of, you know, that's all I see the game as. I know there's more to it, especially with Fortnite, because there's a building thing. But if I want to build something, I'll go on Minecraft. Do you know what I mean? I don't know.
Did you play Fortnite solo or with people? Because
a bit of both.
I was going to say, because multiplayer really changes the way you play the game. And also, like a lot of games where there's the focus is multiplayer more than there is single. Mm. Or solo play, it can really enhance the experience. But as you've played it with both and you still didn't get on with it, then what else can you say other than, well, fine then.
But the one thing I would say with you know, they haven't specified what free to try means. So
I'm assuming
are they just saying that's a demo? Yeah, is it a trial? Yeah, is it a demo?
Maybe you get like 10 hours play, kind of like an EA Access. Yeah. EA Access on Xbox One and Origin Access on PC. Like some games you get like 10 hours play before it comes out a few days early.
Yeah.
Maybe it's that kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I assume it is. The one thing I would say about this is, if you're new to the Battle Royale scene and you want to get a feel for it and you want the best possible chance at liking it, the Call of Duty version is probably the best way to go, because PUBG is, I think everyone knows now, it's still a bit of a mess. It's not very well, even for PCs, it's not very well optimized. No. It runs on Xbox, but it's janky, isn't it? If you're completely new to gaming and, you know, especially to gaming and to this Battle Royale, I think you'd be in for, and especially because that game has been on for so long, there are a lot of good players out there. There's certain games that you've got to jump on that bandwagon as soon as it starts, because otherwise you'll just never be able to catch up. And that's kind of one of, you know, it's one of those games. Same with Fortnite. It's a lot more refined, and it works well. It works on pretty much every system. They could, at this rate, they'll be able to run it off a potato. Do you know what I mean? But I think, again, the skill level kind of is moving so quickly that it's very hard for new players to jump on. So I'd probably say the Call of Duty one would be someone's best chance, because you know it's going to be when I say well made. Call of Duty games, the one thing you can't say they're not is not well made, in terms of they're solid, they're not glitchy messes, you know what you're getting with them, and that's the key, I think, with this. Is it's going to be a solid game. It'll run well. It will have the Call of Duty mechanics, which a lot of people know how that works. So I think out of all of them, it's going to be the most accessible one. So it is one that I think I'm going to have a go at. I'm not probably going to invest in it, though. I'd be very surprised if I did.
That's fair enough. Personally, so I would, you know, my I haven't played it, so I wouldn't say, but for me, I would jump in with Fortnite. I could see the skill level's going to be higher, but it just seems like it'd be more fun, because it doesn't seem to take itself as seriously as the other games.
Mm.
So it depends on what kind of game you're going for. Like PUBG is more realistic. I'm assuming Call of Duty is kind of mixed. Whereas Fortnite is more like an arcadey fun shooter with... But I don't know. I can see where you're coming from, where people might not be sort of advanced in skill, but the people who are playing it are people who have probably been playing Call of Duty for the last 10 years.
Yeah, and they understand their mechanics.
Yeah.
So there is that. Anyway, we'll move on from that, because neither one of us are particularly thing. I think it was the big news that kind of came out towards the end of last week, but we didn't do news last week, so I thought I'd cover it here. Activision have split with Bungie. If you're a fan of Destiny, obviously that's a massive deal. That's a huge deal, especially when we've also found out that Bungie have held on to the rights to Destiny, which means no more Activision getting in the way, and Bungie will have the creative freedom to be able to do what they actually want with the series. I don't know, Peds, where you stand with Destiny. I didn't play the first one, but I did play the second one, and I did put a fair chunk of hours in. Didn't really play it alone. Again, it's one of those things that I think it's better experienced as a group, you know, with at least one other person. Definitely. Which is pretty much how I played it, and I enjoyed it. I got a good 30, 40, maybe 50 hours of play time out of it. I didn't invest in the DLC. That was just, you know, playing with friends and leveling up and doing all that. I think this, obviously, you know, there's certain publishers, isn't there, that have the potential to ruin, not, well, it's, ruin's a harsh word, but have a major impact on the creative freedom of certain games. Activision, I'd say maybe are one of them. EA certainly is.
Activision definitely are.
Yeah, well, there we are. I don't really play many Activision games, so I'm not so clued up with them. But EA, I have played a lot. And Ubisoft, I think, is another one. So I think in terms of for the players, I guess, this could be a huge shift in the developers, in game developer publisher relationships, and how they're gonna, and how these, that could go forward for the whole industry.
Oh, I don't know. The problem you've got with Bungie and Destiny 2 is a lot of the money shit they added was on Bungie's part, not Activision's.
Mm.
So it's actually quite surprising that, you know, it doesn't seem to be just a one-way street with this.
Yeah.
From what I've read. So Bungie are just as much to blame for cocking up Destiny as much as Activision are. And the thing is, I've also read, is a lot of, like, several Activision studios helped fix Destiny 2.
Mm.
So, what is going to happen with Destiny 3? Are they going to be able to make a very good game without the help of anyone else? Or are they going to... Because they obviously needed that help.
Mm.
I think the problem with them is they seem to have high ambition, but they're not able to fulfill it.
Yeah, I'm not sure how big is Bungie as a studio. Obviously, I know they're responsible for Halo and that, but how big are they now as a studio? I'm not sure if they're massive. They're pretty big, but they're not.
I saw on GRK'd when they were talking about it. The two numbers I have in my head is they're either 180 people in the studio or 300. I just can't remember which one.
Should be able to Google it, actually. As soon as I type Bungie in, they'll probably... Normally, as soon as you click on it, it tells you how many people are part of the... thing. Oh, number of employees, 750.
Ah, so a hell of a lot more than I thought.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there's quite a big studio.
Mm. Yeah, very big.
Yeah.
But, I think the trouble is, obviously, I think this is going to be a situation of it depends which context we're going to hear. And we're going to hear reports from Bungie's side probably saying that they were working to unrealistic time frames that Activision were imposing on them, hence why they had to have help from other studios. But then Activision will probably turn around and say Bungie couldn't get the job done, so we had to. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. I think it's a he said, she said type of deal.
Yeah, I think with the first Bungie though, the first Destiny, there was a lot going to be different with the story and stuff. And then the writer and that got left or got sacked because loads of shit went on with Bungie, and that cocked it all up, and so much of it had to change, which is why Destiny, when it came out, I think was also quite broken.
Yeah.
So I think we're really not going to know how this is going to turn out until Destiny 3 comes out. And even then, you're not going to know, because from everything I've heard, even though I've played Destiny 2 myself, and I thought it was all right, the best stuff from Destiny 2 and seems to be the latest stuff. So even in the first year of Destiny or two, you're not going to know how successful it is as a Bungie venture until they get the best bit out. the problem you've got there is people were disappointed with Destiny 2 initially because the way Destiny ended after all the DLC and that, people thought it was a step back. And then they implemented all this market bullshit. So it seems like I said, I genuinely don't know how things will turn out for the game with Bungie on their own. Not because they can't do any, they're not talented or anything, because they clearly are. It's just, it's just, will they be able to deliver a really good game in a reasonable time frame and not fuck it up?
Well, I think it's one of those watch. It's definitely one of those watch this space kind of situations. I definitely think that. On top of that, thinking about it, I know obviously Destiny have the. Obviously, by taking the rights, they also are now responsible for maintaining Destiny 2 and sorting out any upgrades and updates and that. So, I guess that kind of gives them a good start anyway. We'll get to see how they deal with fixing certain things and update the game and how they support the game going forward. That might give us a better idea of how they're going to handle their own game, and whether or not they're going to look for another publisher or they're going to self-publish or however they're going to play it. I think it's definitely it's a watch this space type of deal, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
Yes. So, moving on. Are you aware? Have you followed or have you seen anything about the run-in that Soulja Boy, the rapper, has had with Nintendo recently?
I don't even know who Soulja Boy is.
Cool. Good start. So I can fill you in. So, there was a rapper called Soulja Boy. He had one... He's pretty much a one-hit wonder guy. He had one song in the mid-2000s. I literally cannot remember what it was called. Anyway, I think it was on one of the Need for Speed games, and that's what got him, like, big. But anyway, it's a one-hit wonder type deal. Anyway, towards the end of 2018, literally in the last couple of weeks of 2018, he released a website called SoldierWatch.com. And the way he spelled soldier is S-O-U-L-J-A, because he's gangster, isn't he? So he released this website, Soulja Watch, and on it, he sells basically cheap Chinese crap that he's sourcing from China, and he's just slapping his name on it. But he's obviously claiming that it's all bespoke stuff, and he's selling it at a massively inflated price. So you go on AliExpress and you can buy the exact same stuff just without Soulja Boy's name, and it's literally like the same stuff from the same supplier and everything for up to 10 times less than what he's selling it for just for instance. Anyway, so it landed him in hot water with Nintendo because he started selling handheld gaming systems, emulation systems, I can't remember what they were called, what they're actually called. They called a number of different things, but again, you could get them all from AliExpress. And these little emulation systems had games on. Mainly, the main issue is Nintendo games. You know, all the Nintendo games, all the Mario games and all everything. As we know, Nintendo aren't big fans of people making money off their intellectual property without their say-so. They're especially not so keen when it comes to emulation. So anyway, so Soulja Boy did this thing, and YouTube exploded. Loads of YouTubers kind of pulled him up on it and said, Nintendo are coming for you if you don't do something about this now. He responded on Twitter. He literally went on a bit of a tirade on Twitter, literally calling, he called all the YouTubers who were calling him out, like just calling them names, and he literally tagged Nintendo in a tweet and said, come at me, you can't touch me. Like, he literally called out Nintendo you know, the might of Nintendo, and basically said, come at me, you ain't gonna touch me. Less than a week later, the website disappeared. In fact, the best thing was, a week later, he, if you typed in soldierwatch.com, which was his website, it actually took you to Nintendo's 3DS page. So what that probably tells you is Nintendo sought the challenge, sent him a very strongly worded letter, basically saying, take your website down or we will take you for everything you've got. You know, this is we know how strongly Nintendo do not like people making money off their games without their say so.
Yeah.
Anyways, so everyone thought that was the end of it. This went on over the two and a half, 3 weeks maybe. So a few days ago, he popped up with another website. It's similar thing, soldier_watch.whatever it was. It's exactly the same thing. But and he's carried it on by selling another system. He's called it the Soldier Hand Game Handheld, or something really stupid like that. It's a really stupid name.
Yeah.
This one is an emulation system that doesn't have any games on, which is perfectly legal and above board. The issue is, it completely and utterly rips off the design of the Vita. So you can see where this one's going now. Yeah. You can see Sony getting involved with this one and going, take that down, that looks too much like a Vita. And it does look very, very much like a Vita. Although if you compare them side by side, you can see this one is a very cheap Chinese version of it. But the point is, he is clearly ripping them off. So yeah, obviously after all the controversy he caused and all this and that, he's at it again. He's been back on Twitter. He's been calling everyone out, and he just loves it. You know, the best thing is this system that he's selling it for $99, reduced from $200. That's what his website says. You can go on AliExpress and buy the exact same one for $22.50, something like that, and it is literally the exact same one. So it just shows you how much of a rip-off merchant it is. So yeah, so that's the kind of the history of Soldier Boy and his adventures into the gaming industry.
That's mad. Yeah. I hadn't heard anything about it, to be honest.
Yeah, I
what a tit.
Yeah. I'm not being funny, he's some washed up one hit wonder who still thinks he's current, trying to make himself current again by forcing a big company to sue him. That's pretty much what he's doing. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, maybe he's trying to get some publicity out of it. Maybe he's gonna do a comeback and his new album's gonna be Come At Me, Gamers.
Yeah, you can see it. You can almost see it. You can see it. But anyway, so yeah, that's kind of it. It was a very long-winded thing, but I thought I'd better update you on the beginning of it. So yeah, the new story is that Soldier Boy's at it again. He's released a new console, no games on it, but it rips off the Vita. Apparently, he sells another one with exactly the same name, but it is a different system. That one rips off the PSP, and that one does have games on that are not allowed to be on there. So Nintendo might just send him another very strongly worded letter again. So, you know, for all we know, he might end up in trouble again. So you never know. By next week, I'll probably update you saying he's ran away again, because that's pretty much what he did the first time. Cricken, you've got to... I haven't said hello to anyone in the chat yet. So
neither
hello,
Cricken.
Hello, Brum. Hello, Jasmine. Thanks for tuning in.
I haven't said anything either. If they want me to say it, they can fucking join the podcast.
Yeah. But Cricken, yeah, that's pretty much, you can imagine that's at this next rate, that's what Soldier Boy's gonna do, is call Reggie out for a fight, a 1v1 him. He's probably gonna add, like, call him out and be like 1v1 me on Smash or something like that, isn't he? Winner takes the rights to Nintendo games or something stupid like that.
Can you imagine that?
I've got visions in my head. You know the Tekken series and the storyline behind Tekken. It's like that. If you win the tournament, you get the rights to you get the controlling rights to Nintendo, but through Smash. Anyway, we shall move on. So, this is the last bit of small news before we go on to the main bit. Anyone who's interested in Anthem, which is me and maybe a few other people, hoping it goes well, they've released one of the developers have come out and said how big the game's going to be on release. And the news story, a lot of news stories are saying it's they worded it basically saying that it's a lot bigger than what everyone was expecting. When I've seen the number now, and I actually think it's the other way. I was actually expecting it to be bigger than this. So the game's going to be released, and it's going to be about 30 gig to download. I actually think for the game that it's meant to be, it's a massive open world, and we've seen the gameplay and how detailed everything is. I think 30 gig is on the really overall small, yeah. That's quite small when you consider how big GTA is. And even a game like Gears of War, which isn't a massive sprawling open world, that's like 100 and something gig. And do you know what I mean? So for a game like that to be 30 gig is, I think, incredibly small, actually. That took me by surprise how little that is.
Sea of Thieves?
Sea of Thieves is 36 gig.
Yeah, it's not massive, but is it 30 gig?
No, but even better, there's a new update coming out. Which for Sea of Thieves, it comes out maybe next week, I think. It's going to force you, the update will force you to re-download the game from scratch, but it's because they've been able to, some kind of witchcraft, I don't know what it is, some kind of black magic fuckery. They have been able to take the game and reduce it down to about 15 gig instead of 36. And the game is just exactly the same. So it's space-saving measure. Some kind of black magic fuckery. I don't know how they're doing it, but they've done it. So we can expect that update coming out. I think it's next week. Anyway, so yeah, that was Anthem. I'm actually looking forward to the game. I'm looking forward to it, but not like... I'm not like overhyping about it. I'm not looking too much into it. I don't watch too many trailers because I don't want to hype myself up. I want it to be a good game. I've seen the thing at E3. That's all I need to see. I'll wait and see what happens now and just hope it's good. What about you, Peds? Are you looking forward to Anthem?
Anthem? I don't know, really. Mm. Like I said, when I've said lots of times, it just reminds me of Destiny in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
And then the last time I spoke about it properly was when it was the Game Awards. And I'm pretty sure, because I was listening to the episode back, I'm pretty sure the exact words were, I'm still not sure whether I like her or not. So I don't know. I might give her a go. Maybe.
Yeah.
But there's no guarantee of that.
It's one of those games that I kind of want to get on release, but I don't think I will. Again, it's an EA game. I don't, you know, I think I said in maybe last week's podcast how much I don't like EA and what they've done to Battlefield, and that's the reason why I haven't invested in this last iteration of Battlefield. So I'm very, very tentative going into this. So, you know, again, another time will tell deal. Anyway, so into the main section. So if anyone hasn't been aware, some data miners have found...
One thing you haven't mentioned?
Go on, sorry.
EA...
Yep.
...cancelled...
Oh!
...the open-world, you know, Star Wars game.
I was meant to write that in my notes, and then I forgot to write it in my notes. Yes.
That's another game they've cancelled to do with Star Wars. The last one was the... I know it was... I'm pretty sure it was the Amy Hennig Star Wars title. She, I believe, wrote the story for Uncharted 1, 2, and 3, I think.
Okay.
I think, don't quote me on that, but it's just going to show that EA, that Disney should go to EA and say, give me back Star Wars. We're going to give it to someone else who can make fucking games.
Yep. Shall I tell you what? I think everybody in the chat would agree. I don't know if Factor 5 is still going, but if they are, give it back to them. Rogue Squadron 3, or no, actually it's Rogue Squadron 4, isn't it? Because a third one came in for the GameCube. Yeah. Rogue Squadron 4 on the Switch. Do it. Do it now. Take all of my money and do it now.
Red Faction, if memory serves, they were like...
Factor 5, I think you mean. Red Faction.
Red Faction's a game. Factor 5, sorry. Factor 5 were in the red.
Oh.
Factor 5 basically got to the point where the like company director or something laid everyone off and transferred all the money to a different company owned or something. Shitty lager.
I don't know exactly what happened there, but...
Yeah. But yeah, Rogue Squadron on the GameCube, the second one.
Incredible.
Fucking incredible.
One of my favourite games of all time.
Yeah.
In fact, no, it's not... Oh, I don't know. Definitely top three. I'd say top three for me. It was the first game I got for the GameCube. It's incredible. What on that quick subject then, while we're on it, if Disney came out and kind of said, let's just hypothetically say, they make a massive announcement and go... We've taken the rights to EA. We've taken the rights to Star Wars off EA. And they kind of asked the question, who would you like to see? What developer would you like to see us give the rights to? And what game would you like to be developed? Is there anything that first comes to mind to you, Peds? Because obviously there are a lot of good Star Wars games. You've got Knights of the Old Republic. You've got Jedi Outcast.
Yeah, but Knights of the Old Republic was made by BioWare, which... Part of EA.
So you don't want them touching it?
No.
Anyway. So, yes.
I don't know, because
Cricken just said he liked the MMO. What was that called? That was called, not Knights of the Old Republic. What was it called, Cricken? Do you remember? I can't remember what it was called. Something Old Republic.
It was called The Old Republic. Yeah, it was.
There you go.
It was Knights of the Old Republic. It was just Old Republic.
Yeah. And I never played. I think I've got about 25 hours into Knights of the Old Republic because it's on Game Pass. I haven't finished it, but I do need to go back to that. I thoroughly enjoy it though. I love the timeline. To why is my picture moving? I just see my picture running away. See what the hell's going on. Anyway, oh god, that caught me off guard. Oh god, you've knocked me completely off guard. Yes, I love the timeline. I love the timeline. And I love the fact that there's games that explore the history of Star Wars, you know. I say the history, you know. I mean, there is an actual official timeline, and it's massive. It's oh, hello, someone's joining. I think we got a special guest suddenly joining. Jasm has joined the chat.
Who? What? Where? Why am I here? When did I wake up? Did I come to my own filth? Hello, everyone. Oh, boy. You know, I don't like him flipping about in episode 2 like he does, but that would salvage that for me. Yeah. No, let's put money on that. I agree. And I noticed that Cricket mentioned Star Wars Racer as well, which...
New Star Wars Racer would be awesome. But yeah, for me, a Rogue Squadron 4 would be... All they've got to do is take Rogue Squadron 2. They don't even need to make a new one. Just take that and put it in the Unreal Engine and put it on Switch. And everyone's going to be happy.
That's one of those Dolphin Showcase games, isn't it? Like, you stick it on there, you pop the resolution up and...
That's pretty much all they need to do for the Switch. It really does depend though,
because if you think about it, if you have something like a space type of game, like a Rogue Squadron kind of game, you want to look at like Sega for like they could do like an Outrun. What's the plane version of Outrun?
Afterburner
style game, or you could have Ubisoft even do it, because for me personally, I really liked Starlink. So if you could do a Star Wars game based around that, the Starlink concept, not the Toys for Life thing, but the traveling, like you travel to Tatooine and then you could travel to the Death Star and then you could travel to Jeff's house, you know?
Gotta love Jeff's house. That iconic Star Wars location. exactly. I think there's huge scope, and I think if the trouble, you know, I'd love to know how much money EA have paid Disney for those rights, because they must be an awful lot of money. But then at what point will Disney go, you know what, it's not about the money anymore, you're ruining it, we're having it back, here's a refund, we'll go somewhere else, someone else will take our somebody else will pay us for the rights and actually do a better job than you. You know, where's the line, you know? But yes, there's so many good games, I think, that could be reimagined, revisited. They all need to be revisited, I think, really. I do love the idea of like a Knights of the Old Republic type game, or like the MMO, the Old Republic. I never played it, but I love the idea of it and the story behind it.
I hear it started off quite bad, but got better as it went along.
It's still supported. It's a free to play game now. Mm.
Like it is
still supported. Yeah,
What was? Forgive me. What was the? There was the early 2000s Star Wars MMO. Was that Galaxies? Galaxies. Yeah, the thing I remember reading about that is apparently it was a crazy grind fest when it started, so it was very love or hate it. And then at some point they just increased EXP so to such a degree that it made it trivial for new players, and it also had a lot of old players who were like, well, we just did all that work for nothing, basically.
Yeah.
I know it was a case where it was really mismanaged, so it does seem like they did at least handle that better with Old Republic, and I mean that's of all the universes to do a game like that in.
See, the thing is, there was going to be, before EA took over the rights for Star Wars, there was going to be that it was like Star Wars 1337.
That's right,
I know that's leaked, but it's something else.
That's the Amy Hennig one you were talking about, wasn't it? Because that would be very linear, very
story,
quite Uncharted-esque, right? Yeah. Effectively, which we haven't really, honestly, we haven't really seen a game with Star Wars like that, at least of that production value and scope, I would say.
You've got to think, though, EA, Disney must be looking at EA and thinking, what is going on here? They've cancelled at least two Star Wars games that have been in development. Yeah. One with that Amy Hennig, who done stuff on Uncharted and what have you, and they're not exactly like bad received games. They like critically acclaimed for a lot of things, especially the writing. Mm. The writing more than the fucking gameplay, to be honest.
Yeah.
So it's like when you're taking, getting someone like Amy Hennig, who has a great reputation and standing in the games community for storytelling, and then cancelling the game that she's been working on for several years, you have to be thinking, what is going on with the company and what are they doing with our brand?
I honestly just think that EA don't know.
They're asking their elbow.
I think they I think they just genuinely don't know what to do with Star Wars. I think they've done Battlefield. They did Battlefront, the first one. Yeah. I enjoyed it, but it was very bare bones, but I did enjoy it. I was going to get Battlefront 2, and then that I didn't, for obvious reasons. We all know the reasons why. It was an absolute mess, and that was a typical. That was an EA's greed causing seismic shift kind of in the industry. But they kind of messed it up big time there. And I think they're stuck in the rut. I think they're like, we can't go back to Battlefront because we screwed it up. We've got to wait a little while before we even attempt a Battlefront game again.
See, I played Battlefront.
Just, you know.
Sorry.
No, that's all. I was just. That's pretty much all I had to say.
No, I played Battlefront and I enjoyed it. Don't get me wrong, I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
But then I played it with. It was stunning looking, but I played it with Devlin and Super Dragon 64. And then one day, a couple of us went back to play Battlefront 2 that was on PC, the original version.
The original.
Okay, and yep. I only played it like a couple of times, but it was so much better than the Battlefronts that have come since. They really were. It's disappointing that the game have gone backwards.
Yeah.
And then even screwed up with money. Thing is, when it was announced, there was like, no season pass and stuff like that. And it was like, yes, yes. And then it's like, ha, we fucked you over in another way. Yeah. That's what you were doing, like.
they really flew too close to the sun with that, didn't they? Because that was, like, that's when it made national news. That's when, because it was known that Disney execs or these high-ranking Disney
people
weren't
happy.
Yeah, because it was just such a PR blunder, wasn't it?
Exactly.
I understand the first Battlefront, they had a somewhat tepid critical reaction, would you say? Like, there was a, but I believe it sold, like, I think that it's still like one of the best selling games of this generation. Like, it did really well, probably, you know, it came out at the same time as Force Awakens, so I imagine Disney were pretty happy with them despite the critical reaction to that.
Yeah,
and then I guess since then it's just not been especially because you say it as well, thinking back to it, like, that seemed like such a good match for that idea, didn't it? DICE go into that and given that Battlefield experience.
And they did do a good job. You know, it was tight gameplay. It looks
gorgeous.
Stunning.
Yeah.
Like Battlefield, like the Battlefield games do. They look absolutely stunning. But, you know, there was the. It was very bare bones. It was very, very slim pick, you know, very, very slim and on release. And it took a long time for it to kind of get any meat on its bones.
Well, the big thing with the second one, wasn't it? The second one was they made a big solid dance about it was going to have a campaign mode, because the first one kind of did, but kind of like it was basically just a bunch of challenge maps.
Yeah,
I want to say, right? So it did. It seemed like that was kind of done as a
it's kind of like Titanfall in that respect. There's a story there, but it was done through online, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. Can I put out, Titanfall is an incredible game, and the second one.
The second one
I prefer to the first.
Yeah.
Because of the story more, the single player. Yeah. I just found it really fun to play.
It's Titanfall 2 is amazing, and it's criminal that game has been totally overlooked. And again, I think, you know, we're kind of on. I've kind of gone into bitch about EA mode. And again, that's EA choosing to sacrifice one of their games there, because that's literally what they did for Titanfall 1 and for Titanfall 2. They went, oh well, we'll just stick it literally just before Battlefield games come out, right after, literally like in between Call of Duty and Battlefield. Let's just stick it right in the middle because we don't have any faith in it. And you know what, it's an incredible, like the second one especially is an incredible game.
Yeah.
The gameplay is great. It's such a good game, and that, you know, again, that's probably a series we're not going to see revived for a long, long, long time, if we ever see it, because no one played it.
People who are currently making there is still a Star Wars game in development, and that is being made by Respawn, which are the people who made Titanfall 1 and 2.
So there could be a
very good game coming from them. The problem is I don't remember there being cool mechs you could go in Star Wars. I know there's the AT-AT and the AT-ST, but they're very different to little combat mechs, if you know what I mean.
I assume they'd want to came out for Episode 9, right? Because Battlefront 1 was Force Awakens that came out with, didn't they? And I assume they want
to. Do you know what EA should really do? Is do like an alternate Episode 8. And they should do like a story, a campaign, but make the story really, really good. And then I can have that as my canon Episode 8, because I didn't like it.
Well, the problem is, though, you're going to deny me a Princess Leia floating through space level, aren't you? I'm not okay with that.
Oh, I forgot about that, yeah.
I don't even really mean that ironic. That's strange. I do remember. I remember just kind of like the Imperial March coming into my head as like I read like EA got the, you know, EA have the Star Wars game, they've got that unlocked, and a lot of people were like, no, they've got DICE and everything. And
here's a question for you guys.
It is the feeling that day, and it's
Question for you, right? Because you brought up the whole scene of Princess Leia floating through space, right? I remember a lot of criticisms of it being like Mary Poppins. A couple of years later, Mary Poppins returns
come out. Mary Poppins, y'all.
Yeah? Right?
Oh, yeah.
So, do you think Star Wars 8, indirectly, and the fans criticizing it, created a furore for Mary Poppins, and that's why you came back?
Could be. That, and Guardians of the Galaxy 2. That. Mary Poppins, y'all.
Mary Poppins is back, yeah. Like, tribute, intentional.
I think it started with Guardians of the Galaxy 2, and then obviously the whole Leia floating through space thing kind of helped. But yeah.
Bad film. Right, anyway, you were talking about SNES things. Let's go on to that before we start talking about bloody Mary Poppins more.
No, I'm cool with that. I think
the gaming Twitch cast talking about Mary Poppins, that sounds about right, doesn't it?
The church was actually pretty decent. I saw it with the family, and it was actually quite good. Yeah, it's quite
true. To be honest, though, the Twitch cast isn't necessarily just about games. If you wanted to talk about films at the end of it, you could. If people wanted to ask questions about which Mary Poppins is best, the old one or the new one, then Jasmine can answer that question.
Chat, do what you do, chat. Help us make this very political. Start asking about Brexit and
no,
just completely ruin the podcast. It'll be amazing.
Please don't.
Let's date it.
Both of these two men in chat with me know exactly what happens when politics gets involved in Twitch.
Whether we interviewed them,
I had nothing to do with that incident. It was just Jasm ranting at the racist.
Let's talk SNES, shall we?
Yes, let's talk SNES. So, there's been some data mining going on. And people who are much smarter than me.
Right,
have
can I ask one question before you carry on? I've heard the term data mining, and I understand it's collecting data, but does any of you know how data mining is done?
Haven't got a clue.
I assume it's just scouring the code, right? Like,
yeah, I assume it's probably developing some form of algorithm that searches, decodes things, and I assume.
Yeah, because it's finding things that are dummy that, right? Because the stuff it's found out, the snares on
Cricket says we need a pickaxe. That's probably a good start.
I prefer that. Let's go with that. Yeah.
If we go Minecraft style, we need a diamond pickaxe.
Diamond would be strong. Thinking of gold, where it's like, oh, gold's a stronger than that. But anyway, please continue.
So, Switch. So people were flicking through a update that's about to come out, or very, very soon. It's due to come out for the Switch Online app, the one that gives us the NES games. And they have found quite a big list of SNES games that looks like due to be released very soon, which obviously says SNES games on Switch are imminent. Would you like to know the list?
Can I ask you one more question before you tell
you
us?
May.
Were there any other consoles data mined?
No, not
so
yet.
So what was seen was basically they found names of emulators, and they found the one for the NES one. I forget what they are, but they're the ones that they were used on the NES and SNES Classic. So they found the NES one that is being currently used right now. They found the name of the SNES one. Again, I forget exactly.
Being currently used, yeah.
And
I don't think they found another one yet.
Well, they found two other names that seem to relate to emulators.
Yeah, they can't. They
didn't specify what systems they were. So, I mean, my guess is.
I'm not willing to say N64.
I'm thinking Game Boy / Game Boy Color and Game Boy Advance.
Yeah, I'm not willing to say N64. I think that's. No one really knows what's going on with that for emulation wise.
There's so little communication on all of this, really.
Yeah. N64DD, the disk drive, is a good.
Oh my goodness, yes. Let me make my own F-Zero courses, please.
Mate, hey, for all we know, it could be Game Boy and Virtual Boy. Do you know what I mean? So. But anyway, so there's a list of SNES games that were found during this data mine. I'll quickly go through the list. Stop me if there's a game that you find particularly interesting. So, we have.
Yeah.
Well, we'll just let tell me to move on if you've got nothing to say about it. Super Mario Kart.
Awesome.
Yeah,
like, don't get me wrong, Super Mario Kart now is a bit, going back to, because I played it on the Wii U, it's a bit hard to go back to in the sense of, it feels like instead of turning the cart, you're kind of controlling the map.
Yeah, I was just thinking
but
that, yeah.
I fucking loved Super Mario Kart. It was awesome. I loved it. I remember playing it to death. Even in like local split screen battle mode and stuff, it was awesome.
I still really enjoy it. It's, I mean, there's still a big time trial scene about it. Like the handling, it's not as approachable as recent ones, but I still think it can click with you. And the way you speed up as you do it more, it's not quite the same as the recent games where you get a boost from a power slide.
Yeah.
So it can be really satisfying to build up momentum, and I just love the aesthetic of that game. And remember, these will all be online as well, so the first time
you
officially play...
You
had super rubber banding AI, you had AI-specific items, you had no item boxes non-respawning...
Rainbow Road on that game in the Grand Prix, you can, like, so there's no walls, right? And there's lots of swamps, but they're electric swamps, so you can't even go in, like, if you go into them, you'll spin them out. You'll probably get knocked off by the AI, and you can get knocked off again as soon as Lakitu punches you back. It's a lot of these old games, I say, you can use save states, it's okay. But that one, I'd say, yeah, put one right before.
I remember watching you stream Sonic Mania.
Yes.
You had it. You had like Super Mario Kart levels modded into it, and you did Rainbow Road. And I remember you going through, and you were coming near the end, and you say like, "Oh,
awesome.
If I can hit off now!" And then all of a sudden, you went off the edge. You're like, "No!"
I forgot to the screen there. Right? I was like, "I'm done. This is really cool, but fuck, this is too much." It was quite fun though.
Yeah, and it's always good. I think. The best thing about the Virtual Console and this service is for people who want to play games legitimately then. For them, they can, like, say you're new to the Switch, your first Mario Kart is
8
Deluxe. You can then go back and like play the origin of it. I know for a lot of people it'll be like, 10-minute go of it, but at least you can see yourself where the roots are.
But I talked about this before the PlayStation Classic episode, but I do think it's important that these games are made readily available. I mean, I know they kind of are through the community and emulation, and, you know, obviously I'm a little bit in that myself, but they do need to be out there on the official products as well. I mean, on Reset Era just now, I was reading a thread about people saying, yeah, we want PS1 compatibility on PS4 because we can't easily play these games. I mean, you can if you look in certain corners of the internet, but especially I understand why people don't like the value proposition of the Switch Online, and I've got similar criticisms, but I do like the idea you just get a retro library built in, especially if it is going to grow like this. And it's just wonderful to think people have access to these games right from the off if they get that.
Do you think, would you like to see, obviously they, at the moment, the situation is that they're selecting games for us to have, which is fine. But, you know, if you're paying for the service, would you rather just have the entire library available to you?
Well, it's weird because I know people do miss the Virtual Console. I get why in some ways. I guess because that would have been a more active release schedule. Like, you'd get games every week as opposed to just a few every month.
Yeah.
But I don't know, there's something quite nice about, like, a lot of these games, like, I can't imagine anyone would have, there's a lot of people who wouldn't have, say, bought Blaster Master, but if they've heard about it, you know, kind of a neat little cult favourite NES game, they've just got it available to them, and I don't mind that trade-off so much, especially if, like, I'm one of those weird people who still really likes NES games. I get why they're a bit fiddly, a bit antiquated.
A bit janky.
How dare you?
Dude, I love them, but they kind of are a lot of the time. Like,
I wouldn't say they're janky. They're a bit archaic in a lot of ways, but I wouldn't say they're janky. It's not like you're playing Dark Souls.
I knew I had like just an ominous feeling. I was like, oh, is he gonna say that?
It was actually a tweet the other day saying from somewhere like, oh, what's the controversial opinion you stand by? And I said, Soulsborne games are janky, shitty messes.
I really hope, because there's been one that's going around, but like, what's a positive controversial opinion? I hope you put it on that anyway, just to be a cynical ass, like in the positive.
No, I wouldn't say they jank. Don't get me wrong, there are some janky NES games, which you'll get janky games on various consoles, depending on the developer and the publisher and what have you. But like, playing Super Mario Brothers, it's not a fucking janky game. It may be a bit archaic in a lot of ways. Ghosts and Goblins. I wouldn't say that's janky. That's just fucking ball. That's just solid.
No, it's not
janky. It's ridiculously hard.
The arcade version, I wouldn't say, is the NES one. There's like sprites disappearing and stuff.
That is one of the biggest problems with earlier consoles, actually, sprite flicker.
Yeah. Dude, do you want to go to the next game?
Yeah, I was going to say, there's quite a long list. So.
Yeah, let's not do this for everyone. Yeah. We will.
It's only half past 10. We've only been live for an hour, so it's fine.
Yeah, we got plenty of time. Anyway, Super Soccer is the next one up. I have no idea.
Football game, great.
So, okay, weird thing, just quickly. This was actually on the Super Famicom Mini, and they didn't get Earthbound. So if you think about that, we got Earthbound, they got Super Soccer.
Super Soccer.
Yeah, but they got Mother 3, and we didn't.
But I know a few people like this. It's kind of like a Mode 70 football game. I don't know how well it's held up, but again, this service, you can play the games online, so yeah, for a multiplayer sports game in there, why not?
Yeah, it'll be fun to play for a bit.
Wouldn't it be better if they put like NBA Jam in there, though, than some
licenses with that?
I don't know, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying I think that would, for me personally, I have memories of playing that and not football games because they shit.
What's the recent? Is it NBA Playground, like this virtual successor?
I think so. I think the second.
I suppose that if you want to play something like that. Let's go.
Yep. So next one, Legend of Zelda: Link to the Past.
Yeah, it's alright.
Well,
I'm not going to say anything other than it is the best Zelda. Move on.
It's still very good.
Demon's Crest is fucking awesome.
Demon's Crest is cool as
stream.
Yeah, so I started streaming that, and it's what I abandoned. But that game is just, oh man, if you want to see a SNES game just at the top of its peak aesthetically, and just like a 94 release, and just quickly, it's part of the Gargoyles series, which is also a spin-off of, we were talking about Ghosts and Goblins. It's like one particular red wind demon enemy from those games got his
Firebrand.
Own, like, yeah, Firebrand. He got like his own little 2D action RPG kind of series. And this is like the final installment. Apparently it sold like crap back in its day, so I imagine
it is a wonderful game. The final boss I've seen on it though was ridiculous.
So this is the kind of game I get really excited about, being this sort of service where people will discover it for the first time. At least I hope so. Again, maybe people just like fire it up for a bit and never again. But this is a really cool little, like, it's got such an amazing soundtrack. Like, you'd never expect such haunting melodies out of the snares. It's a cool one. It's a really good one to include in this.
Awesome, cool. I've not got a huge amount of experience with the snares. It's only been recent years that I have, because I grew up with the Mega Drive. So I'll be experiencing a lot of these games from scratch, which is something I'm looking forward to.
To be honest with you, I've probably played a hell of a lot more SNES games now than I did back in the day. Because I had a SNES and a Mega Drive, I'd have games across them, and I wouldn't get games that often neither, because my parents were spiteful, horrible bastards.
Fair enough.
Well, the cards were also like 70 quid, like they could be.
Okay.
yes. Next game, Super Mario World 2, Yoshi's Island.
Nice.
So, Colfin, just very quickly, this was on the Super. This is on the SNES Mini as well. Before this, they only ever re-released the Game Boy Advance Yoshi's Island once on the 3DS Ambassador Program and then on the Wii U VC. Seemingly because it's so, you wouldn't necessarily think it, but this game actually has the Super FX chip. I think specifically the second model, so, you know, Super FX was the film where you could do 3D visuals on SNES. This has a few of them, but I think it uses it a lot for, like, sprite scaling. You get a lot of, like, cool little to the effects, and it shows. It's a gorgeous game, and again, like late SNES games, so they knew what they were doing with the hardware, and then they had that chip as well, and yeah, again, another one that it, like, I'm glad they are doing the original version now, because the Game Boy Advance one was okay, but it was a compromise in a few areas, so I mean, it's an obvious pick, but it's a good one.
It's a good one. Stunt Race FX is the next one.
I've got a big soft spot for this. It runs like crap. Oh, it has horrible input lag, so that's gonna be fun online, because that has an input lag. My god, this game is so jaunty and likable. Like, all the cars are Brum, basically. They've all got little eyeballs. It's got like a really, the soundtrack is really underrated. It's like, it's really jaunty and fun. It kind of explores a few genres. If you could get past the tech, because again, this is a Super FX game, so really rudimentary 3D. You get a smaller window because it can't render the whole resolution, or the frame rate would be even worse if that's somehow possible. But it's really charming. It's a fun inclusion. They haven't re-released this one before as well.
No, I played I played it back. It was one of the very first Retro Monday games I streamed. I only played it for an hour. And it was quite fun. It was a game I recommended playing.
You've got to readjust to it,
it's just because of the frame rate and what have you. it's kind of hard to play, I guess. But then I'm bad at racing games, so. But I also liked that there wasn't just races; there was other things. So I remember doing like obstacle courses or something.
That's right, yeah. It's. I'm not going to say it's a timeless game. Holy shit, it is not. But it's still, it's very likeable. Like, if it's one you give a chance, it might surprise you.
It's cool. Right. Kirby's Dream Course?
Lovely little weird kind of isometric golf game. This was the one, people were generally happy with the SNES Classics game selection. This was the one where people were like, okay, it's a weird inclusion, but it's quite a charming little game. It's got a fun two-player mode. It might be one of the hardest Kirby games. It actually gets really tough, yeah. And Kirby's usually a really easy series, but
yeah.
Lovely soundtrack.
And that's what I like about the Kirby series, because for people like me, who I've said multiple times, I am not a platforming expert at all. Kirby games are nice for me. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
I can feel like I'm good at a platformer without being good at platformers. Do you see what I mean?
Well, they were kind of designed with that right from the start. Like, that was kind of the mission state of Dreamland 1.
And everyone was playing it, weren't
they? As I said, this
the whole flying like, mechanic was added for people who can't really do platforming. But then if you're like more adept at it, at that kind of game, or just gaming in general, then you could not opt not to do any of the floating about and just play the game by jumping around them, aren't you?
Which is what makes this game kind of bizarre, because it's actually pretty technical. You've got like golf meters, you can put spin on Kirby. It's a little weird to describe. You kind of have to play it.
Do you have to hit Kirby around?
Well, he kind of goes off his own volition, so I don't think it's too. It's not like a big club whacking him about.
I was saying, could you imagine like playing Mario Golf and your character is the ball and you just smack him?
On that. On that odd note, are we all aware of the situation with Mario and Yoshi when Mario rides him?
I punch him in the head.
Yeah. Oh my goodness.
Peds, are you aware of what Mario does to Yoshi when he punches him in the head? Punches in the back of the head, yeah. So poor Yoshi.
Isn't this something of abuse of a Nintendo
character.
I read an interview where, I don't know if it was like the artist, someone was like, okay, we originally made it that, but then we felt bad about it, so we tried to make it like, oh no, he's actually pointed, even though he
clearly punched
him. No, he punches him in the head. I think what it is, I'm sure I saw something the other day about it, and because I was watching like Did You Know Gaming or something. And they were saying that it was like a quote from someone who worked on the game and said they thought people outside of Japan wouldn't be happy with that, so they said that he was just pointing. Other places.
Pointing with his fist in the back of his head.
Yeah, he's definitely punching him in the original Super Mario World, but I don't think he does it in any of the other games.
No.
It should be said as well, the Japanese version of Mario World, you can eat the dolphins as Yoshi. Yeah. You can't in the Western one, so again, they made some adjustments for more sensitive.
Cricken suggested maybe Yoshi likes it. Maybe, you know, you never know.
Maybe Yoshi's concealing something. Sandbag.
I was going to say, yeah, sandbag from Smash. Yeah. That's fun.
Give me more. Anyway, next one. Jesus. Pop and Twinbee. Never heard of
this
it.
This is a good cool game. It's wasn't released in America. Yeah, so have you ever heard the term cute-em-up?
Yeah.
Parodius would be under this. There's basically usually Japanese, really jaunty, basically like a regular scrolling shmup, shoot-em-up, horizontal, vertical, with like a really bubblegum aesthetic. This is kind of a big, sort of a minor but relatively large Konami series in it today. Like, he plays these little funny ships with arms. They have their personalities, but they have people riding them. This is probably, I've played a few of them. This is my favorite out of them. Like, it's a really cool. Again, this is the kind of game a lot of people wanted to play, especially in America, where it wasn't released, as I said.
I have a funny
feeling. It's a cool inclusion.
I have a funny feeling I was meant to play this for Retro Monday, but I was ill, and then Devlin played it instead. I think it didn't have like a life system like a traditional shoot 'em up. It had like a health bar and stuff.
I think it might do. Yeah, that there's like you end up with bells on the screen. You can keep shooting them, and they change colors. So you get different abilities. It's quite an evolved game. It's not. It's pretty challenging, but it's not impossibly difficult like a lot of shoot 'em ups are. I mean, I'm probably going to say it's not
is it Danganronpa. No, Donnanpachi. Donnanpachi.
I was going to say Danganronpa is definitely not a shmup.
Donnanpachi or Donnanpach or whatever it's called.
Yeah, like, you know how difficult shmups can be. This one's pretty challenging, but.
Ikaruga.
It's not too bad. You can lower the difficulty on it a bit. Yeah. Again, I love that people will get to try this out for the first time. Definitely worth a go.
Cool. Cool. Well, I look forward to trying it. Next one, Star Fox.
Hey.
Yay. I beat Star Fox for the very first time. In 2016, I want to say.
It's pretty tough, isn't it? Especially you get three routes, don't you? It's not like the 64 game where you kind of pick your path after each level. On this one, you pick it right from the off, don't you?
Yeah, I think I went the middle path. I think I went the normal route anyway. And I think I'd done really well, like not losing many lives at all. And then I got to a certain level and I died enough to continue. And then I carried on with the game as normal from there. It was fun. It's a good game.
Cricket's right. It has an amazing soundtrack as well. The Cornaria theme is so good. Yeah, that's the one that turned up in Starlink as well.
Yeah, Starlink got an awesome remix of that too. When you in Starlink, you get a special ability, for those who don't know. And when you activate it as Fox, you get either Peppy, Slippy... sorry, Peppy... Grum or Falco helping you, and then you got the Corneria theme playing, and it's a remix of that, and it's really fucking cool.
It is the ultimate fins are about to go down kind of theme, isn't it?
That's it is,
really again, frame rate is kind of in a ditch, but you can readjust. And I, with games like this, I tend to not even kind of consciously just sort of put myself into the mindset of playing that in 93 because it was pretty unheard of for a console game to be pushing out polygons like that at that rate. The design is still really solid. You do have to readjust to it, but it still works for me. Again, it might be a bit difficult at first. It's not going to be as timeless as like the 2D games, but it has to be here, and I still get a good kick out of it, as I say.
Yeah. Cool. Next one, Contra 3, The Alien Wars.
Yes.
Did me and you play that together, Jazz, on stream?
Have we played a Contra? I don't know if we have.
I'm sure we played Contra 3 because it was top down in certain sections.
Oh, we might have done, yeah.
I remember being really, really bad at it and you were not as bad.
I think it's still getting over though.
Contra 3 is a brilliant game.
Probably the best Contra. It's probably my favorite.
I think the thing with that game compared to the first two... is there's more variety in the gameplay because you have the top-down levels and stuff.
Well, Contra often does. Like, the first game had, like, the weird bits where you were in kind of a... I don't know how to describe it. It was almost like a third-person shooter.
Oh, it did, yeah. It had, like, the corridor kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah. Like, they've often done that. Sandy's right in chat. The Contra games were notoriously pro-protector over here. seemingly to appease German regulations over not wanting violence with humans in games.
Yeah, yeah.
So they replaced everything with robots, which I actually still really dig.
I mean,
I don't know how high a bar this is, but that's the coolest censorship I've ever seen. I really like the robot designs and stuff, but I can, you know, it's fair enough. They're going to, because that's the other thing, of course. These are, unlike our good friend the PlayStation Classic, these will all seemingly be the NTSC 60Hz versions. So
yes,
we can sleep okay.
Sleep easy.
You know, it's, but yeah, like it's such a kick-ass like side-scrolling action series. It's one of the best action games of this era. So a no-brainer, definitely.
Cool. Next on the list is Kirby Superstar.
Right, now this we did play.
Was really good. That was really good fun.
So this one, it's not a continuous Kirby game, is it? It's like several smaller Kirby games.
Yeah, if I remember correctly, there's several smaller Kirby games, and once you do those several games, you get like a final act. I think it's very, very similar to the Switch Kirby. That is several small acts that, and then you get a final act at the end. But that was good, because I do you remember how long one of the levels took, though? You had to go through doors, and you'd end up in random areas, and we're like, where the hell are we going, man?
So
I
you
don't know why
we
really... sounded like that. It was only like last year.
No, we were higher pitched than that. No, you know, in Smash Ultimate, there's a really huge Kirby stage, the Great Cave Offensive. It's like the one with cannons you can go into. There's like loads of lava pits.
Mm-hmm.
If you play undocked Smash Ultimate, it's the stage you'll be squinting on. That's what that mode is. That's what that stage is based off, the Great Cave Offensive. Which is actually a really cool little mode, because it's kind of a Kirby Metroidvania. Like, I think that's what this game let them do. They kind of experimented with different structures. Like, one of them is, if you recall, Pez, that was like the Meta Knight one where he's, again, a Smash Brothers stage, he's on his big ship, the Halberd.
Oh, yeah, there's like a star, oh my god, he's coming! And Kirby's like smashing through a door.
I'm gonna be weirdly hyperbolic and say it's almost like 2D Uncharted. Like, there's constant chat going on, like, as like all these set pieces take place.
Yeah.
Oddly cinematic, A, for a Kirby game, and B, of its day, but. That's what's kind of cool about this. Like, all the games share the same Kirby gameplay, but they do creative stuff with it, I think, because they have that license to. And there's a few fun mini games in there as well. I feel like this is probably considered the best Kirby game. I don't know if there's a general consensus, but for a while I got
best Kirby game of all time.
What would you say? Because you seem quite good. Do you have
me
Planet Robobot.
I haven't played Planet Robobot. I love Superstar, but I also really like the Switch game, which I keep thinking is Superstar, but it's not. It's Star Allies. Star Allies, to me, is pretty much a sequel to Superstar, the way it's done, if that makes sense. Okay. Also, one of the cool things about Smash Brothers for me was fighting against Marx.
Oh, yeah, it's the final boss of
Superstar.
Yeah, I think he's shown up a few times, yeah.
I remember when you knock him out in there and he's just like, I think he's like a tear running down his eye and he's out cold in space. And then Kirby goes to bed and we're like, oh, I watch him wake up and it's all a dream, but he never did.
Kirby's fucked up. But it's a good game. It's a very, very good game. Yeah, as we kind of implied, it's co-op as well. So I don't know how that'll fare online. There'll be a bit of extra input lag, but it'll probably be relatively playable. As we say, Kirby games are fairly forgiving. So, yeah.
Cool. Next up is Super Ghouls and Ghosts.
Oh, I don't want to play.
No, this one's not as viciously hateful. As like, especially not NES Ghosts and Goblins.
Remember playing it a couple of years back on stream, and someone came into the chat, and they were lovely, like, and they were like giving me tips of if you go here and do this, you'll get certain items. And I think I got to the second level before I was like, I'm not playing anymore.
It's
just such a hard game. I don't care what anyone says, this is a hard game.
Checkpoints are quite far apart on this one as well. Like, you can die and be sent back away, but it's quite, it was an early SNES game, so it's a great, like, and they really tried to put a lot of cool effects on it. It's Capcom, so brilliantly designed little game. It does slow down quite a lot, and that is something you will see for better or worse, accurately emulated on this. I mean, 99% chance it will be anyway. So unfortunately, like when enemies, a lot of enemies are on the screen, it will, you'll get a bit of slowdown, which you did often get on early SNES games. But
a bit like that Metal Slug.
Oh yes. Well, Metal Slug is a spectacle of just like carnage.
Metal Slug is awesome.
Mm-hmm.
I played through Metal Slug 1X3 with Jazzam. And I think
I
played through 4 and 5 with Yearfolds.
Are they they've got quite a few on Switch, haven't they?
Yes, they do, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know what number they got up to. That's right, yeah, because there's a load of the Geo games on Switch, aren't there?
Yeah, fair play.
It's a shame, right? The PS4 version. There's a PS4 version, which is the same as the Wii version, and the PS2 version, I think. And
well, it's an emulation of an emulation, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's the PS2 anthology emulator.
It's annoying because it's got all the Metal Slug games on it, but this not online.
Super Cars and Ghosts, yeah, very good.
Yeah.
I was thinking Contra Fee because I was like, rather gun, but.
Yeah.
Not quite.
Well, cool. To be fair, the way I've seen speedrunners play Ghosts and Goblins and stuff, it may as well be run and gun because they're constantly running and throwing the dagger. Pretty sure it's a dagger because it's faster.
It's usually the dagger in these games, yeah. Unfortunately, they're kind of games where. You'll defeat an enemy and they'll have a weapon and you're like, oh, I don't want that weapon. So you have to like jump precariously around it.
Yeah.
Because otherwise it'll revert.
Castlevania's the same for the earlier games. And then I think from Super Castlevania for onwards, the item would vanish after a little bit. So you just stand there and wait.
And someone introduced that. Yeah. Not here though, so be careful.
Mm. Next on the list is Kirby's Dream Land 3.
So that's Kirby.
Love the Kirby.
Dream Land 3 isn't as well liked as Superstar. I think it's got a really cool little watercolor, pastely aesthetic. The funny thing is, Superstar was a late SNES game. That's like 96. This is like 96.
Very late.
Well, Dream Land 3 is 97. So.
Oh, bloody hell.
Yeah, you think by that point. Dream Land 3 didn't get released over here. Superstar did. Again, to show this is probably the NTSC version, Superstar was called Fun Pack here. But we didn't get Dream Land 3. It's not as well liked. It's a bit slower paced. It's perhaps not as interesting design-wise. But it's still a really... Like, it's got a lovely soundtrack. You might know from... they were in Star Allies, actually. Some of Kirby's friends, like the hamster, the weird blue ball with,
What are they called? Rick?
Yeah, Rick's the hamster. There's the owl. There's the fish who kind of... Kirby sits in the fish's mouth, which is... I mean, I guess it's amicable, so it's okay. It's still a bit strange to me.
Can't remember the names. In Kirby Star Allies, they were added as, like, a free update to a character, which is the three of them.
Right.
So when you go in water, you become the fish. When you're on land, you're the hamster. And when you're in the air, fort, and you turn into the bird. Something like that, anyway.
Is there a cat as well? Like a cat that rolls you around? Katamari style, I think. But yeah, those were introduced in Kirby Dream Land 2, which was on Game Boy. So I guess this one being the sequel to that, they kept those in. But again, another solid Kirby game. Probably not generally people's favourite. But...
When you said about the look of the game, I was thinking to myself, because you said it's got like a nice watercolour kind of look to it. I was thinking, but you're not going to get a nicer looking game than Kirby Yarn.
Epic Yarn.
That's getting a re-release soon.
Yeah,
on 3DS.
But then I was also thinking, I think it's like Power Paintbrush or something. Got like a weird, like, clay painted look.
That's right. It's got like a slot motion clay stuff. I mean, they're very experimental with Kirby, gameplay wise and aesthetic wise, aren't they? They've really explored a lot of stuff. I guess kind of like the character of like the stuff, you know? Some brand.
Yes. Moving on, there is still got a good like 10 games to get through. Super Metroid.
Ooh, best Metroid.
Yeah, best game ever.
I don't know. Super Metroid, I prefer to Fusion, but there's some quality of life improvements in Fusion that Super Metroid could do with, if that makes sense, to make it even better.
Yeah, the unfortunate thing is some of those have been added retroactively, like ROM hacks, but we're obviously not going to get that here. No. But even then, this game still holds up a treat, and it's as good as people say it is.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I've actually seen a ROM somewhere. I don't do ROMs because it's naughty. But I'm sure I saw something called Super Metroid Fusion, which I think was basically Super Metroid with the physics of Fusion.
Yeah.
Right, yeah, cause the button configuration, they had to change quite a lot on GBA because of two fewer face buttons. Yeah. But some of the changes they made, people prefer anyway. So, yeah, people have tried to retroactively add this back into Super. But, yeah, this is... I actually quite like the first two Metroids a lot, but they're not very approachable by today's standards. And especially the first one's pretty janky in some ways. And you get like a lot of repeated level design there, so it gets a bit confusing.
This is the biggest problem with Metroid.
Such a big leap.
One is the lack of map.
Well, you don't have that in two either. I think the design is a little more
linear, I thought.
It is in a way. But yeah, if I'm to recommend some of the Metroid game, I'd still say you can go back to the first two, but you might need a guide handy and you have to go with a certain frame of mind. Super, I can recommend pretty unequivocally, very easily.
Apart from the wall jump section.
Well, you know the bit that got me for the longest time? There's a... you have to use the power bomb when you're in a glass tunnel to break it.
All right.
And it's such a... It was thinking beyond in a way I didn't think to. It's an easy game to get stuck in, so keep a guide handy. But, you know, do try and get lost in it a bit, you know. You certainly will be able to, like, the amazing atmospheric music in that game. And again, just, like, another stunning-looking SNES game. I think what we get at this lineup is pretty spectacular. Really.
Yeah, definitely.
And especially if these all get released at once as well. If they just say, SNES Online... Here's your first lot of games, and they give you all these at once, you know?
Now, please stop disliking our Switch Online videos. You see the ratios on those? Like, the dislikes somewhere. Like, I wonder if this will tip that balance a bit. We'll see.
Possibly. I'd like to see them release all these at once as like almost a goodwill gesture. Here's a load of them, and then they give you, like, your two or three a month or whatever it is. I assume, are they done with NES, or are they going to keep releasing NES as well? That'll be the question.
Like many things with this service, we do not know.
No.
Like, our game's going to be returned now.
And to be honest, I don't think Nintendo know that much either.
But
I think they're figuring out as they go along.
Do you recall, before the Switch release, they said something about every month you're going to get a NES and SNES game.
Yep.
One singular one of each, I believe it was both at the same time.
Yeah.
And then they would be taken away.
Just for the month, you would have them, yeah.
And I think that was so universally hated that they seemed to change based on that.
Yeah.
But the current NES scheme isn't that popular, really. I mean, I wouldn't defend it, but I actually quite like getting the NES games every month. But, you know, that's also not popular, so I wonder if they're... responded to that as well.
The thing for me is Nintendo shouldn't have a problem. They had long enough to get all of their games on the service, and then every month they could get third-party games on the service by negotiating what they need to, if they need to.
Yeah.
I don't get why we have to wait a month to get two games from the NES.
It was two.
Two NES games a month. Yeah. Sometimes three, I think it was at the beginning.
Two NES games,
and then you get like the special game.
Yeah, you get like the special versions, which are basically save states.
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes quite useful ones. It's like more at the end of Ninja Gaiden or Ghosts and Goblins, both very difficult games. So.
Yeah, I wonder if I was to play them, I could say I completed the games.
That's why they're bad.
World record speed run by starting like 99% of the way through.
Yeah, the recent month was weird because it was two games here. Usually it's three, and that's because there was a game, Joy Mecha Fight, which was a Famicom only game. So they put that on the Japanese service, and they got three games as usual. Here they were just like, well, that didn't get released internationally, so they just gave us two. It's not so the
Nintendo logic.
I guess so, yeah. I mean, the thing is, if you have a Japanese account or a way to access the Japanese eShop, you can use the Famicom app on your UK paid online account. So you can get access to it. It shouldn't really have to come to that. But at least there's that option. But because to bring this back around a little bit, that's the other thing we don't really know is like, okay, once the SNES games come in, as you say, is that it for the NES stuff? Or is it going to be like some NES games and some SNES games every month? Yeah. Or be like, what will the ratio? Again, we just don't know so much about those.
Yeah. Next game.
Next game is Super Mario World.
Woo!
Yeah. probably still my favourite 2D Mario.
The game that for me is on par with Super Mario Brothers 3.
I prefer it, but probably by a hair.
It's not Sonic though, is it?
No, it's not. Sonic is a lot more basic, if you ask me. I think I love Sonic and Mario, but I think Sonic is a more basic game than Mario became by Super Mario World. You could play Super Mario 1 and 2 to 3. There is a massive leap in gameplay from 2 to 3. And then 3 to World is like being iterated on again.
Yeah.
And then you go with Sonic to Sonic. You go from World to 64 and there's a massive leap again. And then you go from Sonic 3 and Knuckles to the bin, and that's where you find the rest of the Sonic games.
Where's Sonic Mania? Is that
Sonic top Mania shelf? Is luckily put back on the shelf next to Sonic and Knuckles.
Sorry, Tim, what were you saying?
I was going to say, I actually really enjoyed Sonic Adventure 2 Battle, but, you know.
I enjoyed Sonic Adventure and Sonic Adventure 2, but they're pretty bad games, and they are fucking janky. I remember playing Sonic Adventure 1. I was playing Sonic Adventure 1 on the very first level. You've got this little ramp thing, and then you've got to go past these spikes, then through a little loop, then down another path, and across another bigger loop. And half the time you'd run down that path, you'd go through a fucking wall into the sea.
Aged like the finest wine.
Nice. Finest wine if there's a hole in the bottle.
Yeah.
Cricket saying that. Like everyone's like, I like Sonic Adventure 2. It's a bad game. But
the chow bit was very, very nice.
Those things are adorable, man.
Yeah. The chow really, really helped that game big time.
You know the upcoming Sonic Racing game that's going to have like a legion of chow as a playable character?
Which I'm going to play as.
Good lad. Sorry, what were you saying?
I was going to say, somebody, who was it? I think it was somebody from Sega. Anyway, they've hinted that they are doing a full remake of Sonic Adventure 1 and 2 for the Switch.
Well, they've said, someone said they would like to remake the first Adventure game, basically because he says what Pence did, where he played it and he was like, holy shit, this is, we can improve something.
That was like a co-executive.
I enjoyed it, but it's a bad game.
That was one of the co-executives of Sega, I think it was, who said that, but yeah.
Was it Yuji Naka who made Sonic Adventure 1 and 2?
Could have been.
He produced, in some capacity, yeah. He was still quite involved by that point.
Anyway, let's move on. Pilot Wings.
Yeah, a lovely little... you know, people call Pilot Wings like a tech demo series, and I'm not okay with that, even though they're kind of right.
Same with Wii Sports.
Like, I don't have a cogent argument, because I guess because they're just seen as like... So this one was to show off Mode 7 on the SNES, right? So that thing where they can rotate... like a big map around in the way, so it gives kind of a 3D perspective, even though it's kind of faked.
Yeah.
But it's still... I mean, if Nintendo are going to release a tech demo, it's at least going to be like an inventive one, a very challenging one in this game. This game is very tough, but it's got nice variety to
it. It's got objectives and things as well. It's not just a simple tech demo, is it? It's got more...
Well, there's a lot of like, okay, land this plane correctly after going through Rins.
Wii Sports is a tech demo.
Well, okay, they're good. Well, I like Wii Sports.
Fucking brilliant. I love Wii Sports.
Damn right. But yeah,
it's... best games on the Wii. And Wii U. I played Resort.
Yeah, this one, the Mode 7 look, it can be a bit low res obviously you're not going to go higher than the snares resolution, and if you're rotating a background in the way they do with that at a distance, it is going to be a bit Lego-y, blocky, but yeah, the game still plays very smoothly. The controls are really finely tuned. It's really tough, so do be aware of that, but definitely give it a go. It's quite a lovely soundtrack. Again, it's a bit tech demo-y, I guess, but it's I'd still argue it's more fleshed out and worth your time than that would suggest. It's not a relic, I don't feel like. Yeah. It's not something that just, you know, now that it's 2019, there's no worth in playing, because it's no longer technically impressive. It's still a good game, actually.
That's cool.
Serpo Swing 64, the highest regarded?
I don't know, because there was the 3DS one, which was seen as... I mean, to be fair, that game did have too little content, but I still very much liked it. I don't know, because they don't reference the 64 Pilot Wings. Like, there's a stage in Smash Brothers that is based on the SNES and 3DS Pilot Wings games, but they seem to ignore 64, even though that was the only ever launch game, along with Mario 64, so... you know, half of the console right there at the start, but yeah.
Half the console was the pad.
Oh yeah, true.
Same fucking size as the N64.
Right, next game, F-Zero.
Awesome.
Again, Mode 7, so yep. Like, kind of 3D, kind of not, but still plays very well.
Need to see a remake, like a Switch version. Who developed Pod Racer? Because they need to do F-Zero.
I reckon Sega should go back to F-Zero, I do.
Who did Pod Racer? That's good, because, I mean, there was LucasArts at the time. I guess it would be one of their internal teams?
I guess. I'll tell you now. Pod Racer.
So I don't believe Factor 5 had anything to do with that one.
It was... Jeff Goldblum. Developed by...
Jeff Goldblum.
Developers LucasArts and Pax Sofnica. Sofnica. Yeah.
Hmm. It's on the...
As Cricket says, X and GX are better. GX was fucking brilliant. Sega really fucking knew what they were doing. The problem is they knew what they were doing when it came to making it too hard to...
Well, I will... So, I get what Cricket means. F-Zero is a series that did benefit hugely from 3D. Like, the next one with the stairs one, it still plays super smoothly, but the courses, because of the nature of the technology, the courses are only flat. They're still great, well-designed courses, but you think of the 3D F-Zero games, and they get so creative with the just like amazing roller coasters of like various inversions and loops, and they get to go to town with that in a way that there's one might feel a bit plain, like coming off those, but I still think it's a really solid, well-made.
Yeah, it's like if you've played Mario Kart on the SNES, and then you've played Mario Kart DX, 8 Deluxe. The it's that same kind of difference where it's not just like flat.
I feel like F-Zero is a more drastic change. I feel like.
Oh yeah, like, I know. I agree with it. Was big fuck off, just everything like.
And oh, I suppose Mario Kart.
I was gonna say there's certain levels where you can literally go around like pipes and stuff, but with the gravity thing, you can do that in Mario Kart 8 now as well.
I was gonna say actually, yeah, I suppose it's not far off that now, isn't it? But and there are F-Zero tracks in Mario Kart 8 as well. But yeah, the only other kind of thing with the original F-Zero, no two-player mode, so it is that rare racing game that's single-player only, unfortunately. But
yeah, maybe they'll rectify that this time.
So there are, I believe people have done this by like set up several emulators at the same time to like have split-screen SNES F-Zero, like. Mm. Look this up on YouTube. It's not happening on here. Like, don't get your hopes up. But this is like a weird homebrew thing people have done. But I imagine here, even the ROM as is. But...
Again, though, they could implement like a multiplayer online thing. Could be cool.
Well, if it's the same infrastructure as the NES app, you'll be able to kind of hotspot with someone else.
Yeah.
And you also have that little hand cursor which you can clap with by pressing the button.
Yeah.
So that's your multiplayer SNES F-Zero.
I haven't played any multiplayer with on the NES app.
It works pretty well. There is a bit of extra input lag. It's still playable. Like that is the thing, it has to be done with Switch friends. Which I would like to see them put some sort of matchmaking in there.
No, you're right. Okay. I can understand it more for like a competitive game like that football game. But could you imagine trying to go through a game where you're supposed to be working as a team with some random stranger who just wants to dick about?
Well, I think it would be at like, say like something like a puzzle game where it's just like a save state right before two player match or something like that, and that would be the matchmaking. I wouldn't want to like play through Zelda 1 with a random. I assume that wouldn't go very far, honestly. So that's fair.
Okay, yeah. What's after F-Zero?
Star Fox 2.
Okay. So second time this will be.
These games are on the SNES Mini, because I'm wondering, like, is it just a SNES Mini list?
Well, it's they're porting the emulator over, so these are games that are compatible with it. Or like, you know, they probably don't have to test too much. And to be fair, the SNES Mini has a good chunk of the essential games, so...
I'm not complaining, I got one, but it's right in front of me.
I was going to say, I'm trying to think what games... Because it could almost... I know what you mean, and there are a lot of these games that are on there, so I'm just wondering, how many more games are there?
Okay, so I'll say from ones we've looked at, Pilot Wings... Yeah, Pilot Wings, Pop and Twinbee, and Stunt Race FX were not on the SNES Mini.
No.
So those are quite cool ones to have here. But Star Fox 2 was notoriously unreleased when it came out. Not when it came out initially, because it didn't come out initially. But that was a cool film with the SNES Mini that they put that in there. And yeah, again, make it readily available.
Cool. Super Punch Out.
The first Punch-Out is probably more iconic. I go back and forth on which one I prefer. Have you played these at all, Tim?
I've played Super Punch-Out on my SNES Mini.
Oh, nice. Any kind of impressions from that?
Really enjoyed it. Great fun, real, like...
Good man.
There's a real technicality behind it, and I really enjoy it.
They're stealth puzzle games, aren't they?
Yeah.
Like, they're not really boxing simulators.
No, they're not even puzzle games. They're rhythm action games.
Yeah, there's a lot of ways.
The way I say that is because I've seen people stream and speedrun Punch Out with a blindfold on, and they do everything by the sound of what's happening. All the sound effects, it's not like a rhythm to it, but all the sound effects. They know when to like dodge in a certain way and what have you. It's mad.
They're games about identifying patterns, basically, but sometimes visual. There's kind of a notorious one for the NES game where it was only known in a recent, like an interview, I think like maybe 10 or so years back, like in the What Asks one, where people found out on the NES Punch Out, there's like a bit where someone in the audience takes a photo. And if you press a punch button when they do that, you're guaranteed to knock out the fighter. And nobody knew that for like 20 years, but.
It's impressive.
Those games are full of like little things like that, basically. Like as Penn says, they'll be like.
Want to play more of the Wii one because I want to beat up Donkey Kong and pretend it's Jazz. I just want to fight Donkey Kong because I think it'd be pretty fun to do as Little Mac.
Same.
Without being Smash Brothers. Which is really
fucked up. That's a series where all three games, like, well, there's also the arcade games as well, which are well regarded, but. The console ones, NES, and Wii are all terrific, and this one great. This one again on the SNES Mini, but hey, it's a great SNES game, so get it on there.
Cool. Next game, The Legend of the Mystical Ninja.
Hey,
nice. I heard this. I only thought there was Guillaumon on the 64, and then this one, but I heard something the other day saying there's like about six of them or something.
There's actually a gazillion of them. We got like four of them over here.
I really would like to play some of those games. They look really cool.
So, Doom, I don't know, you might have seen... I think he's changed his username, but Dan on GArcade, he's got...
There's this guy on the forum, guys, for those who are listening, the forum GArcade that we are all from, called Dan. Well... 1 year around Christmas time, they decided to change his name for Christmas, and then after that, every so often, they would change his name at random.
Is that what it is? But the reason I bring up good old Dan, whose ears might be burning right now, I apologize to him, he's got an avatar of like a bizarre, spiky-haired character, like a blue-haired one. That's who is the star of these games, Goemon.
Goemon, yeah.
Yeah,
I said Kuki. Just now. I was thinking of, did you know?
close enough. Yeah, like a really kind of fun, goofy. The series spans multiple genres. Like, it's been a JRPG at some point. It's probably most well known over here as like the kind of Zelda-esque action RPG on the N64, Mystical Ninja, which is a very fond childhood favorite of mine. This game I discovered after that, which is similar. It's maybe a bit more of an action-y kind of game. I don't know how to describe the perspective of it, because it's almost Zelda top-down, but it's like an in-between of that and being a side-on view, but then it also has side-on platformer bits. It's very Japanese, like in aesthetic, in setting, in a bizarre sense of humor that they weren't quite able to translate over that well, but it still kind of works in its own way. It's a very likable series. Like the 64 one I'm more familiar with, but this one's a really cool action game. Two-player co-op as well. And this one was on the Japanese Super Famicom Mini, not on our SNES Mini, so this is a cool one for us to get here.
That's cool. Next on the list, Super Mario All-Stars.
So this was also... So do you remember on Wii they did like a... What would it have been? Would it have been 25th anniversary?
I think it was the 25th anniversary, yeah.
So they hadn't re-released Mario All-Stars up until that point, which, for those who don't know, is Super Mario Bros. 1, 2, 3, and the Lost Levels, aka the Japanese version of Mario 2.
I was going to say and World, but that was Super Mario All-Stars and World.
That's right, yeah. But yeah, they did quite a nice job on these. There are some, yeah, those NES games, but with much souped-up graphics and music, like to bring them more in line to SNES standards.
Yeah.
I'm really fond of them. I really like the kind of aesthetic changes they've made. There's some funny animations they added.
Yeah. The physics changes is like hitbox changes with certain things. Like I was watching a streamer play Lost Levels, and he was showing the Lost Levels version of Super Mario Bros. 2 and normal Super Mario Bros. 2 Japan and NES version to the SNES version, and like if you jump when a piranha plants up at full speed you'll clip through the top of it fine, but on the SNES version you touch any part of that piranha plant you will die.
See, Cricket saying in chat he's not fond of them for, I think, for reasons like that, and he thinks the music is too remixy. Yeah, they do change the kind of atmosphere of the games a bit, which I think is inevitably going to be subjective, especially because of how iconic the NES ones are.
Mm.
The nice thing here, of course, we've got Mario 1 and 3 so far on the NES side, presumably 2 at some point as well, and maybe Lost Levels. But if they're going to include this, it means you get a choice between the remakes or the originals. So,
that's pretty cool.
Yeah, again, forgive me, we didn't finish that anecdote. We mentioned the Wii 25th anniversary Mario release earlier, because that was literally just this ROM on a disc for like £20, which that wasn't, I mean, it was a bit of a weirdly meager.
I thought it was a £40 game, I did.
No, it's just that. They did more for like the Kirby.
Well, I said I thought it was more as in it cost more.
Oh, they probably did, yeah, actually.
No, in Nintendo, it was £50.
And I think that was also PAL over here, so Rejoice and all that. But yeah, so the only other time they re-released this, it's never been on the Virtual Console, wasn't on the SNES Mini. So quite nice to see it here. I guess they don't mind putting it here if they're giving you Mario 1 and 3 anyway on the NES. Whereas I suppose before they didn't want people to buy this just instead of all the individual games.
Yeah.
So quite nice we're getting it.
It's cool. Right, final game on the list. Breath of Fire 2.
I promise I won't be too long on this. The first one is actually kind of what got me into JRPGs on the Game Boy Advance, funny enough. They did kind of straight ports of them on there. This is a really cool inclusion, so it's a Capcom RPG series. They're quite traditional in some ways, they're quite tropey, but they do have a unique feel of their own. There's like some cool stuff, like your character can turn into a dragon. They get kind of weirdly dark in places as well. Unfortunately, this is, of all the games on this list, I would say this is the one you really need like a ROM hack or two on. There's a lot of things like your walking speed is too slow. It's quite a grindy game, and very notoriously, this is one of those games with like a terrible, terrible localization. There's things like you'll ask the question, and if you select yes, you've actually selected no. And there's like sentences that are basically nonsense, or it's clearly, it felt like it was put together in like a weekend. And they kept that the same on the Game Boy Advance version as well. So cheers, Capcom. It's nice they spend the money when they can. But there's like a lot of ROM hacks on this where like they fix things like the running speed. And so it's cool to have an RPG on here. It's probably not an ideal way to play it, and I can't imagine many people will get far on it in this state. Unfortunately, it's still a cool inclusion.
Isn't a Final Fantasy on there?
I don't know if Square would play all on that. So I imagine something like Breath of Fire 2, Capcom probably gave for pretty cheap. Like a Final Fantasy, maybe. Maybe we'll see.
I'm surprised Mega Man X and that isn't on there, but why would they when there's the Mega Man Legacy X collection or Mega Man Legacy collection?
Yeah, when there's overlap like that, they probably want to. I mean, to be honest, it's still cool. We've seen quite a lot of third-party stuff on this. Although, again, you do wonder, will they take some of that off when they don't want to pay the license anymore? Or we'll see.
Only time will tell.
So, yeah, sorry, go on.
Oh, I was just going to say, what do we think of the list?
It's a good list.
And do you want me to very quickly recap all the games, just so everyone remembers what they are? Okay, Super Mario Kart, Super Soccer, Legend of Zelda Link to the Past, Demon Quest, Super Mario World 2 Yoshi's Island, Stunt Race FX, Kirby's Dream Course, Pop and Twinbee, Star Fox, Contra 3 Alien Wars, Kirby Superstar, Super Ghouls and Ghosts, Kirby Dream Land 3, Super Metroid, Super Mario World, Pilot Wings, F-Zero, Star Fox 2, Super Punch-Out, Legend of the Mystic Ninja, Super Mario All-Stars, and Breath of Fire 2.
That's a very... Oh, fuck.
How did you forget that one, too?
In general, it's a good list of games. There's not a lot on there that's like a surprise, I guess. For me, at least, it seems to be quite popular classic games for the most part. There's nothing out of the ordinary, like, oh my god, that's like a cult classic that no many people have heard of, and it's amazing. But otherwise, it's good. Fuck the football game.
That's your plan.
Also, Cricken, when you mentioned Home Improvement, it is a bad game, right? But if you've not played Batman Forever, then you don't know what a bad SNES game is.
Could you imagine them going to the negotiations to like pay Tim Allen and whoever owns the rights to Home Improvement so they can put the Home Improvement SNES game on? I want to go to that timeline. That timeline's got to be proper fucked up. That's got to be amazing.
Maybe in that timeline the game was good.
That pairs us not get too good. But yeah, it's a lovely list. Yeah, I suppose it's at least so unpredictable it could have been. I mean, stuff like the thing I get a kick out of is the games they haven't re-released, or at least have not re-released often. So stuff like Stunt Race, or that's why I thought Mario All-Stars was quite a cool one as well. And of course, we can assume this will be expanded, so we'll probably get like Donkey Kong Countries on there. Mm-hmm. I mean, do you two, off the top of your head, have any games where you're like, oh, why is that not on there, or oh, you hope it will be on there?
Like I said, I'm not very experienced with the SNES library, and it's only recently that I've really started to explore it. But I did play a very good game. Who was it? Was it Devlin? I think it was Devlin that suggested it during one of my streams. And I think it was called Hangsu. Was it Hangsu?
That mech game.
Yeah.
Agane, is it?
No, Hang. So it's Hangsu.
How do you spell that?
I don't know. I'm trying that myself.
What kind of what drama is it? Is it
How do I describe it? Were you there, Peds, when I was playing that? I think you were.
Was this the same stream you played Bubsy?
Yes, it was, yeah.
I'm pretty sure it's Hagane you're thinking of. Because isn't it like a game where you play as a sort of a mech? He's got like a the show My Naivety. Yeah. So, he's got like a samurai design.
Yes.
It's like a, yeah, he's slashing the sword a lot. It's a notoriously really bloody difficult game.
Yeah.
That would be a super cool inclusion.
That'd be a great game.
It's a Hudson game, so I guess Konami owns it now.
Honestly, there's nothing for me either that would stand out. Like, because like with Doom, you haven't played a lot of SNES games. I never played a lot of SNES games back in the day, so I wouldn't really think about it myself.
Earthbound?
Earthbound would be nice to have. Earthbound would be nice to have.
Mother 3.
That'd be GBA.
If they ever get round
to
it.
When we get to GBA, yeah, hopefully.
Yeah.
What I would like to see on there is games that haven't been released outside of Japan, or even that have been released outside of Japan but not in Europe and the UK. I say Europe and the UK because some games do get released in Europe and not the UK, I think, don't they, sometimes? That have happened in the past? I don't know. Anyway, it would be nice to get some of those games translated from Japanese to English, or the games that were released in America but not over here. Would come here on that on via this platform, like they kind of did with Sin and Punishment with Wii, and they did
cool,
with Super Mario RPG, I think. Though
yeah,
that was released over here, though, weren't it? What other games did you with?
No, Mario RPG didn't come out on SNES over here, it came out on Wii.
That was another game, man, yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying, there's a few games like that that I would like them to do again.
So, we've got a good precedent set where, going by this list, I think there might be one or two NES examples of this as well, I forget, but they're clearly willing to put games on there that came out in America, but not PAL territories. But we just saw with the NES app, if there's a Japan-only game, they're just not going to give us it or anything in place of it, unless they buck that trend. So that's... I don't know. Again, you can access them at least fairly easily on the Japanese, on the Super Famicom app, if you can get to that Japanese eShop. Again, it shouldn't have to come to that. Like, I think they should just stick those games on our app, and if there's, like, a language barrier, just put a warning up front.
Warning, Japanese only.
Any players
good luck.
It wouldn't be so
what
bad for a lot of
games.
Castlevania, I'd love Castlevania 4 on there.
Yeah, are you surprised there's not seen on the list, or... Is it a game that you think
is there any Konami games on the list?
Yeah, they'd be one of the bigger supporters of both this, and Konami will do re-releases if they're minimal effort like this.
I know, but what I'm saying is, was in that list, was there any Konami games?
Contra 3, Pop and Twinbee. I feel like there was another one.
I don't know.
Especially because
Bram Stroker came back and took back the rights for Dracula, I don't know.
Mystical Ninja as well, that's Konami.
Yeah.
I was just thinking, because obviously so many of these games were on the SNES Mini, obviously no Castlevania, so you would have thought maybe there was already that working relationship there for them to get the...
Right.
Maybe obviously
that's,
it's not on this list.
Maybe
it's
haven't got
due
all
to come.
The games yet listed.
Yeah.
Maybe it's just what they've discovered so far.
I mean... Yeah.
Well, I wonder if Konami are charging a bit more for Castlevania. Like, I have no idea how those negotiations talks go down, but like on the NES app when that launched, they had Gradius, which I assume would probably be one of the cheaper games Konami would license out. But Castlevania, like with the Netflix show, and like it has a lot of notoriety, but like maybe they're just, I don't know, maybe they're not going to do that, at least just yet for that reason, but. Because we haven't seen any on the NES side either. But
no,
hopefully in time. Because Super Castlevania 4 is a lovely, lovely little game. That's
do all they need to put on
favorites.
There? Is Turtles.
Oh, yeah.
The Turtles games. The arcade style ones.
Konami again.
Because I enjoy playing through Turtles with them. That's fun. Except for I died on Shredder. I wasn't happy
Turtles
with
in Time, innit? That's the one.
Yeah.
Turtles in Time is good. As well as the one before that. But. I don't think that. I think that came out on NES, not SNES.
So they actually did re-release the very first NES Turtles game, kind of the infamous one, which again talking of janky games. And they actually
janky.
Did.
It was great.
It's very janky. They put it on Wii Virtual Console, and it actually got delisted down the line. Because I think that happened with Xbox Live Arcade as well. They had like the late '80s. Arcade Turtles game on there, I think another one. And you know, sometimes that happens with online games. They get delisted if a license expires.
Yeah.
That happened there. So, again, I imagine Nintendo probably don't want to... That's probably too expensive a negotiation for what this is. Mm. But it would be super cool, because a lot of those Konami Turtles games are really good. Like, 2-3 on NES, and as you say, Turtles of Time on NES is particularly great.
Do you think, if this is all accurate, and next week they announce SNES games are coming, and this is the starting lineup, and they're going to add to this list of SNES games, and then they say GBA's coming, Game Boy's coming, and you know, all the usual. Do you think would that suddenly be worth the money? So your £20 a year or whatever you spend, do you think all these SNES games with the view of getting Game Boy and all the other ones, will that suddenly make it worth the money? What do you think?
So I think Finns still need to improve on the online play side for people to be happy, and I don't know how rapidly we're going to see progress on that front. I do think on this side, I could see, again, I'm picking up those YouTube videos with like the dislike to like ratio. I could see that maybe evening out over time. I'm honestly on board with this idea of just like I'm gonna pay for online anyway, especially with the family plan where it works out to like £3 some for the year if you have 8 people on that. I love the idea of just having, again, I get why people want the virtual console back in a way, but at the same time it is quite nice that we all reluctantly put money down for the online, especially if you do it as a single subscription, but then it is kind of cool you get access to all these games. And well, that's why I'm happy we're not buying them individually. This, if it has to be something in place of that, I actually don't mind this in a way where you just get a bunch of them like this, just as part of the subscription. I mean, I guess you don't own them, but again, like especially with a family plan, like just speaking personally, I'm paying so little for that. Like, I love the idea I just get access, because I wouldn't be buying these individually. Like, I've rebought a lot of these so many times by this point, I don't know if I could justify that, but I like just having them included as part of that subscription. And again, I'm one of those weirdos who's played the NES app a lot, but I can imagine for a lot of the people who the NES stuff is too antiquated, this is probably a bit closer to, not everyone will care, but I think more people will when you get further along with the systems. Like, you get SNES on there, like Game Boy Advance, I imagine people will be very excited about as well. I think it's definitely going in the... Like, I don't think people are going to be fully happy with the Switch Online, just because I think Nintendo's infrastructure is kind of woefully behind on that front, unfortunately, in many ways.
Yeah, but the thing is like Cricken is saying in chat, is yes, Nintendo's online subscription is cheaper. It is cheaper in that you're paying about half the amount a year. To be fair, if you get Xbox Live Gold, it's £40 a year, I think.
Yeah.
And if you buy just a normal sub of the
Game Pass,
the Nintendo Online, it is £30 a year. The price difference is £10. And on
Wait, hold on. Switch isn't £30 a year, is it?
It is, isn't it?
Yeah, it's £30.
£30 a year.
No, I thought it was like £35 for the family plan, and then...
No, it's £20 a year. It's
£20 a year, is it?
Yeah, you could, as I said, there's the family plan thing where it's like £35, but you can divide that between up to 8 people. So it starts out at like 20 something.
There you go, Cricket said it's £17 a year.
I was thinking of the family price then, because that's what I got, is the family one. But still, at £17 to £40, and usually if you get a CD, go to something like CD Keys or somewhere, you'll get it for £30, the Xbox Live price. You have roughly about half the price. Yes, you get NES and SNES games, But the online itself is fucking arse compared to Xbox Live, right? And on Xbox Live, an Xbox Live with games with gold, you get four, sometimes new games for the Xbox One. So you get two games a month, and then you get two Xbox 360 games a month. So the price for Xbox Live Gold compared to the Switch, while it is double the price, you're getting a fuck ton more than double the value for it. Yay, I get a subscription to a game that I could pick up in a bargain bin for a pound. Whoopee fucking do!
Wait, are you talking about like the NES and SNES stuff? Dude, it's so expensive.
Some of it's really cheap. Yeah. I bought a load of stuff after my last Retro Monday stuff. It was like last year. I was like, oh, I'm going to start picking up a load of stuff. And some of the games are like £3.
I mean, I suppose that's another thing as well about like the value of these games in 2019, where, you know, for me, a Retrohead, they have a lot of value, but also through many re-releases and, you know, whether Nintendo like it or not, through the ubiquity of ROMs being shared as well, like they might not be seen as valuable in that sense. I think the other thing that makes this kind of weird is someone signing up to the subscription later on versus day one is getting everything and much more from people getting into it day one. It kind of works out weirdly like that when you compare it to PlayStation Plus or Xbox Live Gold, where you start off and you only get the games from that month and onwards. This is, again, this is kind of the question mark with this. Is like, well, will games get rotated out, or is it just going to keep growing? Like, that'd be great if so, but I don't know how realistic that is. And again, I don't know if, is that a little weird, the idea that you're there earlier so you get less value than people asleep? You can go nuts trying to make sense of this all.
I get what you're saying. It's like, like I was saying about the games and the Xbox Live and the games and the Switch Online. As well as that, it's like, we play Mario Kart on a Monday and you get problems with disconnect. You get problems with actually being able to join the game. You have to go in certain ways to get into the game, which you didn't have. You had disconnect and sometimes not being able to join occasionally on the Wii U, but it wasn't as bad on Wii U as it is on Switch. It was better online on the Wii U for Mario Kart 8. Smash Brothers is laggy as shit most of the time when I've seen people play it. When I've played it, it's been laggy quite a bit.
I've had fairly good luck. I mean, part of the problem is the Wi-Fi chip and the Switch isn't. It seems like it's not that great, unfortunately. So you can go.
And you've got to think
people are on like a could be on like a tethered mobile connection as well. Like, there's quite a few ways you can play the Switch, so that might be the side effect of that. But yeah, because it's peer to peer as well, isn't it? Generally, Switch stuff as opposed to
dedicated.
Right. Yeah. Which again, when you're paying for that, it gets a little.
Like, I can understand, it's cheaper, but for what you get, it is minimal effort put in comparison to the other services. Like, the Wii U, while it was a flop in a lot of ways, the online was a lot better, and it was free.
There's certainly features I want from it, like the, I still can't believe you can't message on Switch. That seems like such a basic thing,
there's not even fucking voice chat.
Well, there is.
No, there's not.
But with an asterisk. So.
You may as well just give your friend your phone number and just say, oh, let's just jump on WhatsApp and have a group chat.
Yeah.
Well, you know what I'm saying? It's the problem you've got is you're getting your NES games and you're paying half the price. Even if you get your SNES games at half the price, it's still not great. They could at least every so often chuck in a crappy little new game.
Well, I don't know if they'll. I guess Nintendo. I guess they didn't want to do exactly what the competition did on that front, so maybe this was easier and cheaper on their front than to kind of license out new games. I don't know if they're. again, there might be a question of value if they worry about people just waiting for a game to go free on like a PlayStation Plus or Xbox like Gold kind of thing, like a newer one, maybe they kind of feel just have the retro stuff be in that realm. I'm trying to get into their headspace when thinking through all of this, and it's not always easy with that. They can be
personally, I think
kooky.
They are looking at the competition and thinking we should do something similar, but they don't really know what to do because Nintendo have always been online way behind when it comes to online.
I think the uncertainty could be the kind of frustrating thing here, because they've made kind of vague comments about, we'll keep working on the online, we'll try and improve it, but there's really nothing committal there.
Yeah, so, and I think another big factor is because they're a Japanese company, and a lot of the stuff for Nintendo is based in Japan, and online isn't as big in Japan for gaming, I don't think, if memory serves correctly. Because from what I remember, handheld gaming is the biggest thing in Japan more than anything.
Yeah, it is. Massive. That China and Indonesia, I think it is.
Well, it is. Some of those are through mobile games, which played online, right, though, sometimes, or they have some sort of online component. I don't know. Maybe it's less of a focus.
Maybe they
there,
do just
sure.
like taking the piss. Yeah, it's hard to say what is going through people's heads and that kind of thing, and maybe they haven't got the infrastructures they like Microsoft have to compete.
Well,
with the front.
The PS3 online was it wasn't considered as good as Xbox Live on the 360. I think it was still seen as pretty alright. It seems like it's something they did improve with the PS4.
Yeah.
I think that's the frustrating thing with Nintendo, where they perhaps haven't. There's really not been much metric of progress. Like, they didn't start out online particularly great, and they, there's things like, at least they got. I don't know if you guys remember, like Wii and DS, you had like individual friend codes for each game.
Oh,
and like in this friend list, you had
that's
to.
That's the thing that annoys me about this gen, with this like, gen, this the switch to Wii U. Your Wii U, you could just add your friend code. Wii U, you just add your friend's name. Switch you back to fucking friend codes.
Well, the weird thing is that they want you to be able to do whatever username you want. They don't want you to have to go through like, this is already taken. So on Wii U, they had like a, this is your display username, and then this is the one people add you by. Maybe they thought that was confusing, I don't know, but it was kind of a shock to see we're back to the 12-digit
That's my biggest problem, though. It's just like, they've kind of gone backwards a little bit this console to the Wii U's online, and then they've put a charge on top.
Yeah, I think that's the, because the moment they were like, we're going to start charging for this, like, I think the, because that was especially once Sony got into paid online, like Nintendo had the at least their free kind of clause, they don't have that now. I imagine a lot of people are probably buying the online begrudgingly, right? Just to sort of like,
I did.
Again, with the family plan, I'm like, okay, fine, I'll stick a few quid down. I'm pretty happy reasonably with that. I'm still playing Smash Online a lot, and it's been pretty, honestly, I haven't really had much problem on it lately, but I do feel, it does feel a bit kind of, again, it's just not that metric of progress I think that people would want. There's kind of a complacency on an online system that's just kind of been stuck in there, kind of a mediocre place for a while, and they still don't have messages. Get your messaging. I just keep going back to that. That's the one I can't believe. like, I'll say compared to, like, I'd still take the Switch as it is over the Wii U's, like, I think people forget how just horribly slow the Wii U interface is to do anything. The Switch is, for how many features it's missing, at least it's so much more elegant on that front. Forgive me, dude. We've kind of been chatting away here. Do you have anything to kind of add? Any kind of thoughts on top of those?
No, not huge. But what I do think, though, is I think Nintendo are playing. I think they're playing the long game. I think they they're looking at this as they're charging your 20 quid a year or whatever is £17 a year or £3 a month, whatever it works out at, based on their main selling point, to be honest, is probably the games that they're giving you, the NES games and soon to be SNES games. And then kind of online just seems to be something they've kind of added in. So I almost feel like that's their priority. But I think it's going to get to the point where they're doing this as a trial. Like they're doing this to just to see the general reaction and see what players are happy with and that. So that's why I think the SNES games are going to come out. I think you'll find general overall consumer happiness will kind of increase because it's SNES games and that's what people want. And I think we're looking at a future, and I'm not saying this is happening this year. I'm saying I think the future we're looking at is we're going to have big libraries. Nintendo will give us big libraries of NES, SNES, GBA, maybe even Dolphin. Well, not Dolphin, is it? That'd be something.
Hey, guys, coming in. By the way, yeah. It's all down.
Yeah. GameCube. There's no reason why the Switch can't run GameCube games. Like, you know, I think if Nintendo, in their wisdom, can do it. And then I think we're looking at rather than your £20 a year or £17 a year, I think they're going to be looking at a Netflix style streaming service. I think that's the route we're going down now.
I think Nintendo are thinking, sure, we've done fuck all with online for the last two generations. Why not just stick a charge on it and do even fucking less?
Honestly, I reckon maybe in the next, I don't know, 2-3 years, maybe even longer than that, it'll be you pay your $9.99 a month, but you've got your NES app, your SNES app, your GB, your Game Boy app, your GBA app, your Wii, your GameCube app, and they've got big libraries of every game, and that's basically what you're paying for, and the ability to play online. But I think that's kind of their long game. That's kind of where I think they're aiming for in the future.
I suppose the frustration is we're not there at that point, and
no.
People are kind of wondering why, like, given the time they've had. And I think that's kind of I mean, they are big faceless corporate. I mean, not completely faceless, but you know, it's still, as a fan, perhaps too much for a fan, it is nice to see, like, the Switch has largely been, like, a pretty big happy success story, like a very good PR thing. Again, I've got no investment in them, so I should probably not be talking in those terms. That's weird and creepy, stop that jazzing. But it's, you know what I mean, like the Switch has been kind of cool in that sense, but this has been big thing that's just kind of weighed that down, really, isn't it? Like, Switch talk is so often be positive, like, oh, we want this game on Switch, or can you believe they can run this on Switch? Oh, the Switch is the system you can play everywhere. By the way, the online's not really what we want. You know what I mean? It's always that anchor that kind of weighs down otherwise generally very positive talk around this system. And it's kind of a shame, and it does feel like it could have been avoided.
It's not like Nintendo haven't had a long time to sort something out online. Yeah,
that's what we mean.
They've had 2 years with the Switch, but then they had the Wii U and the Wii with online. They could have done something to improve more than what they have. It's been like 10 years since the Wii was online.
Well, that's what we're saying, like, what Doom's kind of proposition, what are they going to do in the long term? I think that's why people are frustrated, like, why are we not there now?
Yeah,
exactly, like, but how long is the long term?
That's the $1 million question, really, isn't it?
Because they...
Well, I don't think Doom has a figure on that.
The amount of... Even since the online was announced for the Switch, it's been pretty much fucking all negative.
Yeah, it is a shame. I'll tell you what, let's kind of try and end this on a happy note, because otherwise we're all just going to cry on our pillows tonight. What SNES game are we excited to play on our Switches?
Off Mega the list or in general?
Well, Pez just went with one off the list, so I think anything goes.
I only went with it because it's Mega Man X is on the Switch. It's a SNES game, but it's... on the Mega Man Legacy Collection. That's why I said it. It was a joke, it was.
It's a good joke, though, because Mega Man X is tremendous. It's very good. Doom, especially, I'm interested to hear from you, because, as you say, it sounds like you don't have as much SNES experience, so that's what's kind of exciting about this.
You must play Bubsy, we already know that.
Yeah. I think I played the Mega
Man. Well, I'm really going to cry into my pillow now, Pat. It's great. Yeah. but what game are you? What game or games are you particularly interested in?
I probably couldn't pluck one out of the air like that, so I'm going to look at the list of the ones that have already come out.
I'll read Cricken's comment. Cricken says, Yoshi's Island, Starwind, Star Fox was Starwind every year, wasn't it? Yeah. Or Castlevania 4, if I don't already play them on emulator by then.
Yeah.
There's a lot of features I kind of wish were on the NES, like on the NES app that are on unofficial emulators, like Fast Forward and stuff, but those are the best emulated NES stuff Nintendo has done for what that's worth. Like, they look better than they ever have. There's no kind of horrible darkening filter on them. They do desperately need...
says Contra 3.
Good lad. So yeah, like, we've got the reassurance these are going to look and run really well, like they did on the SNES Classic as well. By and large, I think there's like a few minor inaccuracies, but by and large, they are very good. So Contra 3 will look and run tremendously on their chips. As it should do, because Contra 3 is wonderful. But yeah, I'll probably try and play this online a bit, like maybe with people from my Nintendo, like Nintendo South Wales, the meetup group, or try, like, get my brother to, like, you want to play Pop and Twimby? Which is not a question I think I'd be able to phrase in any other way than, like, really sheepishly. And
what was that game you kept like, trying to make me play all the time? It was that two-player shoot 'em up we were playing?
It sounds like that would have been Pop and Twimby, but I don't think it was.
It was a Steam game, it was.
Oh, was it, like a shmup sort of thing?
Yeah.
What was that? Yeah, there's a few
of them. Shoot it, and then you do a lot, and it go across to you.
Oh, you're thinking of the Neo Geo one, Twinkle Star Sprites.
Yeah, that was fun, sort of.
I was the only person who was enamored with that because everyone else in chat was like, "What the fuck is this?" and you were like, "What the fuck is this?" and I was like,
"Yeah,
I really
enjoyed it when I won."
Which was often, was it?
I think we won. I won a game each, and then I won the last one, so I win.
Hey.
Best game ever.
You know that might be on Switch as well because again, Neo Geo games, so it might be like on the downloadable. So. There we go. any other SNES games where, because as I said, like I think the online, I mean, I just for the novelty of finally being able to play these games online for the first time. The
thing is, sorry for interrupting, but you have a SNES Mini. So what out of the games that are not on the SNES Mini would you like to try that's on that list?
On that list, Pop and Twin, yeah. Pop and Twinbee is sticking out to me. I think that's something I want to try. I want to type Demon Crest. Let's have a look. Yeah, those two games are the two that really stand out, I would say. They're the two... Put it this way, when it drops and the list comes out, one of those two games are going to be the first game I try.
Nice.
So two really cool hidden gem picks there, so fair play. Well, that's the other thing. Do we want to make predictions on when this will drop? Because... Bear in mind stuff, anything you go on that, it could be
I reckon months. There's going to be a direct at some point in the next month or so,
well,
and they'll come out in March.
I think they've got, at the end of the month, they've got an investors meeting, and they generally like going in to investors meetings with announcements, so, or potentially release. So I think we're going to hear about it next week, I think. Within the next 10 days, we're going to hear about it. Mm. And I think we're going to get it for Easter period.
I reckon Nintendo are going to update the Switch for Valentine's Day with a big heart in it. and you click on it, and it opens up the SNES app.
Is that where you were going with that? Was that going to be the thing the investors loved?
Yeah, yeah.
Loved? Oh, love? That's awesome. And Cricken, you are a very bad man for suggesting that. He says they'll be selling the SNES games to see if they can get away with it. Bad Cricken. No, Cricken.
Now, the first thing they'll be announcing is Bubsy, I think. That'll be the first game they announce.
Bad Doom! Bad Doom!
To their investors.
The thing is, when I was about
the investors meeting.
When I was about 8 or something, I actually really liked Bubsy.
Bad 8-year-old Ped, so did I when I was 5. Bad 8-year-old Ped.
It's only after a while when you play more and more games, you're like, damn, that was a bad game. I actually remember, I never owned it, I rented it, and I couldn't rent it at one point because my parents wouldn't let me. I got so angry, I punched my Mega Drive because that's what's playing on, and broke my Mega Drive.
Wait, did you punch your Mega Drive over Bubsy? Oh, that's the most fucking depressing form.
And the best thing, you broke your Mega Drive over Bubsy.
My uncle gave me his then.
That's my most Mega Drive in the world because I'm fucking bouncing the fuck out. Fuck. Fuck. Oh. I'm now forever depressed.
I think that if we title this this episode, it's something like Jasm gets triggered. Bubsy triggered.
Jasm loses his shirt over Bubsy. Yeah. Again. No, again. Like, yeah, again. Yeah.
Have they ever done a 3D Bubsy game? And if not,
oh, they
why
did
haven't
on,
they?
On PS1.
I'm finding
it. Called, isn't it?
It's Bubsy 3D.
It's a new Bubsy. I genuinely want to see one of you guys on the GRK channel streaming the newest Bubsy on Steam.
Oh, that's got to be me, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Well, okay, so the weird thing is they did like one that was like a kind of a middle-of-the-road, bland, mediocre, like 2.5D platformer, which makes it by far the best Bubsy game.
There you go, you can play it.
standards, you know, that's not the highest bar to clear. But
you just said it was the best Bubsy ever. You were playing it.
Don't take that statement out of its context from what came before it.
We just take that like clip, like Peds, when you're putting this on YouTube, just take that clip of Jasm saying that and post just that on YouTube. Just post that quote on YouTube.
Best
and just spam
ever.
It everywhere. Or like slightly manipulate it to make it sound like he's saying Bubsy's the best game ever or something like that.
Right, I'm going to be looking up like definitions of libel and whether I can.
Yo, Jasm, seriously.
Where can I take this? Can I?
Can you just say? Can you just say Bubsy's the best game ever for a laugh?
Depends. I don't want to like spontaneously combust into.
Don't worry, it won't be the quote, and it won't be like.
Cricket, do you not know Bubsy 3D? Oh man, you guys have got to see Bubsy 3D.
It's awful. And
it's the PS1 Superman 64, basically, and that's not really hyperbole.
I don't know, because at least Superman doesn't constantly have a stupid, annoying voice that speaks constantly.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons we love Bubsy, because he's so chatty and witty and. The fuck did this turn to the Bubsy podcast?
Yeah, I genuinely think I think every month, at the end of the month, we need to discuss Bubsy together and why it is Jasm's favourite game.
Yeah. Because he's quoted it. He's quoted it now, isn't he? So
he's quoted it as the best game ever.
Yeah. So
This is the most fucked up Chinese whispers I've ever heard. It's gonna start being me, like, saying Bubsy will lead us into the new age of fucking.
See, he said it! There, he just said it. There you go. There's your clip.
Quick, someone clip it!
It's the worst day of my life.
Grunt!
ChimpsRS has just said, Bubsy also had a pilot episode for an animated series sponsored by Taco Bell in 1993.
That's true.
He also has a Bubsy emote.
I do. Not my own channel.
Crickham says Jasm's top three games. Number three, Doki Doki Lit Club. Two is Metroid on the NES. And number one, obviously, is Bubsy 3D. It's confirmed.
Jasm's favourite game is... Third is Bubsy 2.
For fuck's sake.
Second is Bubsy 1. And first is Bubsy 3D.
Is the Atari Jaguar game like number four?
No, no, no. Walt is his favorite games are the Bubsy series. His favorite section in any game is Castlevania 3 Tetris the level. I think he still has nightmares about that now.
Oh, Peds, I meant to send you and Cricket and other people this. In Zelda 2, there was like a drop in block section as well. Oh. And you want to talk me just like curling up into like a protected ball, just wanting to die. It's, so yeah, it's just like, it's just a Bubsy release. God damn it, Dom. Don't put it in writing, that makes it official.
I'll remember it for the rest of my life now. Chimps has just said, Bubsy was awarded most hype for a character of 1993 by Electronic Gaming Monthly. That was probably voted by Jasm then, wasn't it, in that case? He was the one voted for it.
I was a very misguided two-year-old.
Yeah.
Yeah. So one game fan's best new character award.
Again, the judge must have been Jasm that day.
The thing is, though, is we do actually have you now quoted as saying Bubsy is the best game ever. So
And he's just said that Bubsy will lead us into the new age. So what he's saying is he worships Bubsy as some kind of deity.
Sure, why not?
I bet you any money, right? You go to Jasmine's house, you've got a big poster of Bubsy on the wall, and on his shelf is different colour yarn balls.
It's immeasurably creepy. It's
he's got it on his ceiling, so it's always there. It's looking down at him.
Well, he looks down on us all, for he's the benevolent tower that
No, Jasm, I asked Doom this question last week when I did the little like interview kind of thing. But why is Charizard much cooler than Blastoise?
He's not, though.
Doom, I'm not talking to you.
Forgive me, I still need to go back and listen to the whole thing. I'm a Charmander boy. I love Charmander.
Yay! So with taste.
But I love little Squirtle, and Blastoise is cool as hell. In fact, I had Pokemon, weirdly, even though I'm a Charmander Charizard fellow, I had Pokemon Blue, so...
I did as well.
Our intentions are...
Do you know what, alright? I know this is nothing to do with anything we've talked about, but I was talking about this in my stream earlier about Pokemon and how the size of Pokemon really are just strange. Like, a Charizard is shorter than me. It's a big fucking dragon-looking thing, and it's tiny. Could you imagine me saying to my Charizard, oh, fly, jumping on his back and expecting to take me down to Kanto? It would die! It would die before it'd get a foot out the door!
They'd be trying.
Anyway, guys, is there any questions you would like to ask us before we wrap up? We try and do this at the end of the episode each week because you, the listeners and viewers, are, in fact, the lifeblood of the show, other than me. So...
Well, that's insane.
I'm joking. Seriously, though, is there anything you would like to ask us about?
Doom, stop that.
I think Grum's clipped it.
Slander.
Grum's clipped it.
Oh, my own podcast
co-host is slandering my good name.
Do you know what? I think the next time I play a Pokemon game, I am going to name the main character Jasmine, and then every Pokemon I catch, I'm going to name after a Bubsy character or enemy.
Just like variants of that. Bubsy 2.
How would you improve the forum? The best
more
way...
Bubsy.
More Bubsy, yeah. But the best way to improve the forum is to try and reach out to get more people to join. So the forum can grow. To be honest, the forum, the way it is at the moment, for me personally, I really enjoy it. It's not too fast-paced. The people on there, while you do get the occasional spat between people, because it's in human nature to do that, the people generally there are very nice people. And for me, I'm glad to be part of the community, and the only way to improve it would just be to get more people there.
Exposure.
This is the thing with the Twitch channel, and there's Twitter and all that, and hopefully that will expand GRK's reach
and people will, you know, pop in, check it out.
Yeah.
I want more cat pictures.
You would really reset error.
The cat pictures
everywhere. I think that's
Do put your cat pictures everywhere.
That's one thing I like about G Arcade is it's like, yeah, we take the piss a bit about reset it being overly strict with modding. But what I like about G Arcade is it tends to be quite lax with its moderation. Unless there is like something happening where a mod needs to step in, because we kind of moderate ourselves, so to speak. We know when to not go too far, and if someone does go too far, then something is done about it. And I think that is a good way of doing it. I can understand with Reset Era, it's a bigger community and what have you, so it probably has to be run differently. But you know,
G Arcade is quite tight knit, isn't it? Like, it's fairly active. It's not as active as obviously something like Reset Era, but I think, as you say, the rules are different because of that.
It's comfortably active, though.
Yeah, I'd say that. Yeah.
And when you get these forums, I mean, obviously, I don't know how many active users, but there's about 3,000 people that have signed up to the G Arcade, which is a fair amount. I don't know how many are active at that, but I would say the level of activity on the forum is comfortable and enjoyable, because you can post something and your post doesn't get your thread doesn't immediately get lost in the ether on like page 10 within like half an hour of you posting. You know, everything flows at a very nice pace. Where when you go to some of these bigger forums, it's nuts. You're constantly having to bump posts because you're dropping behind so often, and it's
woof, woof.
You know.
Yeah. Well, that's cool to hear from you, Doom, because you're a very recent member as well, aren't you? So it's really nice you've gotten that kind of impression from it. So really cool to hear, man.
Yeah. Peds is playing with the stream.
Well, Crickens asked a good question. What emulator do we want after SNES on Switch? What system? Should we be realistic about this?
No. What does your heart say?
Original Xbox. Fuck it, why not? Let's go wild.
To be realistic for me personally, I would think I would want emulation of the DS, which has the emulation of the GBA and Game Boy in it as well.
Well, animation. Actually, Ted, you cannot play original Game Boy games.
No, the original DS, you could play Game Boy games on as well. They just used to stick out at the top, bottom, didn't they?
No, it's GBA only. GBA SP, the second backlit model. That was the last.
That's what it was. What I'm thinking of is it used to stick out the back. All right, my bad. But anyway, I would like to have GameCube on there, so that the people who keep nagging for re-releases of or remasters of GameCube games all the time, so I don't get my brand new shiny games, can go fuck themselves.
I think that's a fair.
Well, do you also have an answer where you want people to fuck? Let's not finish that thought. Just answer to me, please.
Yeah.
Please answer.
For me as well, it's got to be... if we're looking slightly more unrealistic, I want GameCube. It's obvious that I think most of my posts are, or most of the reason why I'm on the forum is GameCube related. If you've seen my tweet where I've recently got my game room, it's very GameCube centric. I've got 4 GameCubes, put it that way. I don't know what to do with them all. So yeah, I'd like that. But if we're looking realistically, I'd just simply like to have a Game Boy Color and GBA emulator. I think it's going to come bundled as one. Those three kind of makes sense. At the very least, you want to see Game Boy and Game Boy Color. Realistically, I want a Game Boy / all the others. Otherwise, give me Dolphin.
Yeah.
Actual Dolphin.
chimps.
Well, Game Boy Advance would be sorry, just quickly. Game Boy Advance would be good because they did do them on Wii U Virtual Console. They were well emulated there, but that was always going to be a weird fit for them, just only on a home console, where you could play them on the gamepad, but you obviously tethered to the Wii U, and they never really properly released them on 3DS. They did like the thing for early buyers, but so this, I mean, Switch is such a good format for. Because then you get like both a home console and a handheld version, so those would be great for that, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Jim Saras said, "Who do you think is going to win the GR Game of the Year?"
Monster Boy.
I genuinely think, with the way most places suck Rockstar's dick,
yeah,
Red Dead Redemption 2 will win.
It's all right. It's not going to be the end of the world, guy. You sounded so dejected, Doom. It's okay. Right. The cowboy horse game will win, but it's okay.
What I think should win is Mega Man 11.
Well, this games G Arcade is quite, even though we do complain about them, it's quite Nintendo centric, isn't it? So
yeah,
maybe Smash. I mean, it's not been like a. It's not be as much for Nintendo.
I don't think it'll be Smash. I think it'll be Red Dead Redemption or Spider-Man or something like that.
Well, Sony had a good year in terms of big releases, didn't they? So yeah, maybe one of those.
Yeah, I'd probably agree with Peds. It's probably going to be Red Dead or God of War or Spider-Man.
Spider-Man. Nick Rex asks. Nick Rex asks, who would you like to see in Smash after Joker?
So, should we go with Nintendo characters or first?
I am going to go with who I think should be in there. Sakurai.
Sakurai? That'd be the ultimate self-insert fan fiction, then. That's fun.
Or Sandbag.
Or Sandbag.
Sandbag would be amazing. They put piranha plants in, why not Sandbag?
Well, I was going to say, mine might be a cop-out. I want someone that I would never expect, like piranha plants. I want Sakurai to make me go, what the fuck are you doing? But in a really good way. Like, Piranha Plant did, and I'm really excited to play with Piranha Plant. To be fair, Joker, I don't think anyone really called that either, so. Give me more outlandish one, but also give me Shantae.
Power Ranger.
Oh, no, Power Ranger.
Yes, sorry, the music playing is music from a Power Rangers game on the SNES.
Which Power Ranger of all of them?
White or green?
Green Ranger.
The same one. Did you see the trailer for the new Mighty Morphin Power Rangers game? At the end of it, it was like a fighting game, and then like someone loses. Then Tommy, the guy who played Tommy, goes, "It's Morphin time!" At the end of it.
Oh, does
he? Yeah. Johnny Ombosch for Smash.
What would I like to see? You know what? I'm gonna go really, really. Really outlandish here.
He wants the paper tip from Word.
Yeah. No, I got real outlandish here, and it'll never happen. But I'd love to see someone like Bumblebee or Optimus Prime in the game. I think that'd be amazing. I think they would fit. I think you could see them fitting in the game, and I'd love that. I think it'd be awesome.
You know, that would make Peter. That would give Peter Cullen, the voice of Optimus, work and money. If you ever see that guy in interviews, he's the sweetest.
Yeah, he is.
He's such a sweetheart. I want him to keep getting work.
I'm pretty sure they modelled Optimus Prime's persona after himself.
I was listening to something before, and Peter Cullen was saying the voice of Optimus Prime. And the mannerisms of his voice and things are based on his older brother who was in the Marines, I think.
Ah. Oh, also,
he's authoritative, isn't he? So makes sense. Yeah.
I suppose you guys know that Peter Cullen's also the voice of Eeyore.
Yep.
You want Eeyore?
Yeah. Which I think is really cool.
Well, do you know as well? He's also, I believe, the first voice of Mario as well, because he voiced him on like obviously a kind of crappy Donkey Kong cartoon. Yeah, like they did a bunch of arcade-based cartoons in the early 80s, and yeah, he was Mario in that.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Did you also know that Big the Cat is the same voice actor as Duke Nukem?
So can we have both Duke and Big in Smash? Have we got room for both?
Jasmine, say Bubsy.
Yeah, just say Bubsy. Let's get this over with.
Aero the Acrobats?
No, just say Bubsy. Just say the word Bubsy.
No, you know what? Let's just get the podcast to a complete standstill.
No, I wanted to say Bubsy, so... Listen, look, I'm going to be straight with you. You say Bubsy this once, and then when I download the audio and give it to Doom, every question we ask you, he's going to edit out the sound and just have you say Bubsy. What's your favourite game, Bubsy? How many times you used the toilet today, Jasmine? Bubsy. But no, seriously though, your out there character, something like Piranha Plant, would be hard to really do because there's already Piranha Plant. Like, what other kind of out there character you want? Like a Waddle Dee or something?
Banjo.
Well, yeah, oh, Banjo would be lovely, wouldn't it? Okay. There was some
stack of Goombas.
There's some good suggestions. Crooked said Dante and Tubi. I could see Tubi, that being the heroine from Neo Automata.
You could have Dante versus Bayonetta.
That would be cool.
I'm surprised they haven't done a crossover game with those two yet.
One's Sega, one's Capcom, so. Yeah. Thing is, though, is Capcom have, done. Years ago, Capcom and Nintendo are pretty tight because they even made a couple of Zelda games.
Yes, they did. They made quite a few, actually.
Yeah, Nintendo generally have a... it's funny because I think throughout the NES to N64 era, they had up and down relationships with third parties. I think they're generally on track now, aren't they? Capcom, say... Namco at one point was really not butting heads with them, late NES era, so... Yeah, I guess that's why we can get all these characters in Smash, isn't there? That things are kosher on that front.
The slime creature from Dragon Quest, Nick Rex says. But then I was thinking, instead of the slime creature from Dragon Quest, go to Blue Dragon instead and have the poo enemies.
So, one thing I saw earlier, someone said they want a guy from Dragon Quest, which has been rumoured about. They want that
Eldrick,
well,
is it?
Well, what people want is for it to zoom in on that face, and people are like, is it Goku? And then it zooms out, it's like, no, it's a Dragon Quest guy, because it's the same artist, so it looks like the same kind of face, so people would think it's Goku, but this was so cruel. But that'll be the closest thing you probably get to Goku in there.
Right, guys, Ash Williams, as in Ash from Evil Dead.
Oh my god, yes! That'd be amazing.
Right, I would say we've got time for one very last question before we end the podcast. Make it a very fun or good or whatever one. First question, we'll answer, and then we go in to bed. Probably.
But yeah.
Okay, job, bugger them lot. What TV franchise or film franchise would you think would work well as a game?
Oh my goodness. I haven't seen it yet, but that Bandersnatch thing, the one on Netflix, which it's kind of based off an early 80s game, it didn't come out anyway, but that's a choose your own adventure sort of thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
So that could be like a Telltale sort of thing, isn't it? I mean, I guess it kind of already is that, based on what I know of it. But...
Yeah, but the problem is with Telltale is the... You had choices, but you never really had any consequences to those choices.
They all go back to the same path, don't they?
Yeah.
Kind of a budget limitation.
I think Batman was meant to actually do that. A bit
Batman
better.
Was really cool. I only played the first season, but...
I played either.
That does some really clever things with that. Apparently, pretty much everything Telltale did make the money, which is why they went bust. But yeah, I quite like the first season.
What about you, Duke?
Cricket.
What would I like to see? I'd like to see a real crazy, just nothing makes sense, but that's what makes it so fun type of game. Based on a film called Escape from LA.
Awesome.
Oh, John Carpenter, okay.
Yeah. One, The main character is called Snake Plissken, the greatest name for a main character in the history of main characters. Two, he wears an eye patch, and he's got the huskiest voice known to man. And the whole movie is just nuts. Just nothing makes sense, but that's why it makes sense. And it's just over the top, crazy action. That's just massive fun. And I think that would be just such a fun game to just blast through. You know, I just think I could, yeah. So I'd like to see like a game.
People
like that.
Say Solid Snake and the different snakes are based on Snake Plissken, but I read that the original Snake character was based on Kyle Reese from Terminator.
Yeah, there's a variety of influences. C2, when you were saying you wanted something completely out there, I don't know why, but I was like, is he going to say the Mighty Boosh? Does he want the Mighty Boosh game as well? Because that would be... What the hell incredible. Would that be? But I want it.
Yeah,
I really thought that's where that was going.
Right, last...
Also,
what's that?
I was going to say, Crickens just put a question in.
Yeah, he did just before, after I said it, but I was just about to say about that. Who would you like to voice Samus in the next Metroid? I reckon she should be silent.
I was going to say, yeah. It could sound a bit like, obviously, don't want the woman to talk. It's like, no, it's because that works in Metroid. We don't need a lot of chat.
I know, it's like, Samus runs into a room, and there's like, loads of stuff to scan. She's like, oh, I gotta scan stuff now. Oh, I gotta shoot things again. What's she gonna say if she's on her own with no one to talk to?
I'm changing my answer. I want Peds to voice. Because my goodness, would that be something based on what we just hear? That was his audition, whether he knew it or not. My God, he passed with flying colours.
Get the audition tape going.
But who would you like to hear? Sigourney Weaver? Metroid That'd is very, cool. very, very based on yeah. Alien.
That'd be a good one.
I'm blanking on her name. She was Chloe in Life is Strange. Really prolific voice actress who also had a funny YouTube show called Hey Ash, What You Playing? What's her name?
Which Chloe?
Chloe
can't remember.
From Life is Strange. Do you know who I'm referring to?
Yeah, didn't she also do Tiny Tina in Borderlands 2?
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah, I know you're on about, but I can't think of her name.
Chimps put Kylie Jenner.
Ashley Birch is who I'm thinking of. She'd be a cool choice.
I would like Samus to be voiced by
Peter Cullen.
Joe DiMaggio.
Peter Cullen. Joe DiMaggio. I didn't do the brain voice, is it? Same thing we do every night, Pinky, trying to portray all the Metroids. Where is actual voice?
No, I don't want Charles Martin age who in through fucking Metroid. Every time you do a spin jab, woo, 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 woo.
No, you sold me on that as well, Fed. So if you want to do it.
Serious one though, Sigourney Weaver would be cool simply because of the alien connection with Metroid. So it kind of come full circle then, if you know what I mean.
Right.
Or Tara Strong.
Yeah, I'd agree.
I fucking love Tara Strong. She's awesome voice actor. She's fucking top notch. She really is. I was gonna say.
I can't do the Harley Quinn voice.
Yeah, I remember listening to a podcast, Fat Man and Batman, with Kevin Smith a couple of years back, and he had Tara Strong on there, and he said, "What would the conversation go like between these characters?" And then she done like four different voices or five different voices of these people having a conversation together. Like, it was fucking awesome.
Yeah, I guess we'll go with for the service answers who if she was to be voiced, but I'd only want it to be like for one or two cutscenes near the end or something like that. Like, I'm okay with Metroid being kind of a silent game, basically.
Yeah.
Have some, like, the Prime games had like lore, didn't they, through like logs and stuff, but just in text form. Like, I don't need everything explained. Like, I want mystery, and I want just like storytelling through visuals. Rather than it being overly talky.
I reckon you should have Samus run into, burst into a room, and Ridley, and she's like, oh, not Ridley again. And then Ridley turns around and says something back, and it's the voice of the guy who did the voice of Iago in Aladdin.
Gilbert Godfrey. Oh, God. Actually, one video worth looking up, I think he visited, like, the Games Radar offices, and they got him just to sell, like, loads of video game lines.
Yeah.
So they have, like, Gilbert, like, the parrot from Aladdin, like, saying, you're almost a gel sandwich, you know, and shit like that. It's so good.
Or someone like nuts, like Brian Blessed or someone like that. I'm talking for Samus now.
Well, that would not be a sign of Metroid game if anybody does it. I'd be okay with that in that case.
The problem is you'd have to turn your volume really low because he'd probably break your speakers on your TV.
I'd be so happy for it.
Chips and shame Stephen Hawking died would have been an ideal for Samus.
Oh, no.
Right. I don't think we're going to have any more questions now. We have been live for nearly 3 hours, even though we haven't actually been doing the podcast for the full 3 hours, because I do the whole starting screen with music so people can, you know, ease themselves in. That sounds wrong. Chilling, chat, and wait.
I wouldn't have thought anything of that. I'm really thinking, like, well, what's the name?
Anyway, thank you guys for listening, and thank you to Jasm and Doom for taking part. I know
it's been
Doom,
emotional.
It has been. I know Doom have taken charge for the majority of the podcast. So everyone, give him a clap.
That's team effort. It's always a team effort here.
Yeah. With that, I'm going to say goodbye. Thank you for tuning in, guys. Don't forget, we are a Twitch channel, as well as
an online community.
An online community from grk.co.uk. So please, if you get 5 seconds, jump up on there. Check out the forum. It's a good laugh. It's a good place. Some nice people.
Where can we find you on social media, Peds?
Find me on social media.
Yeah, watch your Twitch and watch your Twitter.
My Twitch is twitch.tvp3dz. My Twitter is something similar.
Jazz, where can we find you?
Jazzm, JAZZEM on Twitch and Twitter. I haven't been the past week, but I am streaming Mother 3 at time of... time of speaking. I'm hoping to at some point this weekend, although Pez, when will this podcast go out?
Sunday.
Okay, so I might have played it this past weekend. But then days afterwards anyway, so that's fun.
That's cool. You can find me at twitch.com/doomspoonthe, because somebody nicked the doomspoon. I'm very unhappy about that. You can find me on Twitter at the doomspoon, all one word, no underscores, none of that crap.
And Tim, what game have you been streaming?
Lately, on my channel, I've been doing Sea of Thieves, especially if I've got a friend of mine called Lord Atten. You'll see him featured in my Sea of Thieves streams quite often. So
that's
Sea of Thieves
fun,
has been the big one.
Yeah, it's great fun.
And if you're listening to this and not watching it live, you are not going to know we're on twitch.tv/grkuk. So yeah, come and check out the forum, come and check out the streams. There's usually a stream every day from one of us or the GRK community channel itself. And with that, I will say goodbye, guys, because it is almost 12 and I want to go sleep. I'm going to take my kids swimming in the morning. Bye.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Bubs is the best. Dude, just you're Jazzer, man. You said Bubs is the best. Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye.